This I am confident. If all hell was standing against me, as it is, making intercession with all of its demonic power to resist the praise and resist the affection from being expressed through my life, I would defeat them. I would put them in silence. Navajo. For greater is he that is in me than he. Father, we ask you tonight to let there be, O God, such Holy Ghost conviction, such working of your power, that no shadow of darkness could stand in a place, O God, of affecting a single soul's life, that every person, O Lord, would be convinced of their sin and of their wrongdoing and turn from every form of iniquity to serve the living God. Hallelujah. Music just isn't loud enough for me. That's loud. That's good. Thank you. They die. The Lord said every witch power of witchcraft, every person who practices those things in communication with devils and demon spirits, let them be put out from among you. And I say it dies. Yeah. Satan, you have no rights. And we give you none. come, it's certain. You met your doom at Calvary. Quit acting, quit pretending, quit posing like you have some kind of power, right? For the smallest child anointed of God is greater power still. Satan is powerless, then how much less in power are those his servants who would try to withstand the work of God and the power of his divine grace? That's funny. That's funny. Oh Lord, may your people arise to the revelation and the insights of God. Of that which we confront, O God, and the powers of darkness that would try to stop and silence the preaching of the gospel, the declaration of your praise, the sounds of your voice heard in the midst of your people. Father, I pray, O God, that those who are mighty in you and valiant, O God, and everyone who wants to be, will begin to rise up, O Lord, no longer trapped in uncertainty, no longer blinded by the powers of darkness and the spiritual things, but now try to withstand that which you commanded. For, O God, who can resist you? No one can resist the Lord. The reality of it is that God has made us the people from which he will do the things that his might, his power, his glory has purposed to do. And if there are no people who know how to stand, if there are no people who know how to move, if there are no people who know how to lay hold on those things which God has given, then there will be no outworking of that glorious master plan. There will be no display of how much greater his power is than any power that exists until someone knows the Lord. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Chibai Otoye.
There is so much power in our praise, and there's so much power in our prayer, and there's so much power when we believe God and we act upon what he has done for us and empowered us to do throughout the earth. There is power. The enemy cannot resist. He cannot stand against us. There is power in believing and receiving and moving in our Almighty God. There is power. I look at Luke chapter 10, where Jesus sent out the 70 others, and I like this part where he sent out the 70 others because it's not the 12 apostles. So it gets away from people saying it's only the pastor, it's only the apostle, it's only the evangelist. And no, it's the 70 others, and I'm an other, and you're an other. We're an other. Jesus. And they came back rejoicing. They came back saying, even the devils are subject unto us. Amen. And Jesus said, I see Satan fall from heaven. I see him fall as lightning from heaven. I see him fall because somebody would believe and move and act upon what I gave them power to do. He's given us power. He said, don't rejoice because the devils are subject unto you, but rejoice because you are heir and joint heir with Jesus Christ the righteous. Your name is written. Your name is written in heaven. You have that fellowship. You have that relationship. You have that communion with the Father. You've been restored back to your original place in God, where you are one in him. He is in you and you are in him. Rejoice in this. Oh, hallelujah. And then Jesus rejoiced in his spirit. Oh, every Every time we move in, God, Father, is rejoicing. Every time we do what He has given us to do, and we push back the powers of darkness that rule the lives of people in a nation, in a city, in our home, in our workplace. Every time we move out in God and we take a hold and we believe God and we push back the lying powers of darkness, God is rejoicing over His people that will believe Him, that will act upon what He says. Like He told Peter, I give you the keys of the kingdom. You've got the key. You've got the key to unlock the prison doors. You've got the key to love people right to Jesus. You've got the keys. You've got the keys. You have the keys in your hand. Yeah. Yeah. Jesus paid for a church that would hinder lawlessness, that the powers of darkness could not stand against. Jesus paid for this, and for us to live it, us to believe it, us to walk it out. It don't matter how much scripture you know. If you memorize Genesis to Revelation, is He in you? Do you know Him? Do you believe Him? Are you walking it out? Are you living it? Is Christ living in you? And what He did. What He did when He was on the earth, is He doing it through you? If He's in you, we should be doing what He's doing. There's power. There's so much power. One can put 1,000. And when we come together, this many people praising, the powers of darkness in this area have to back off. We take authority. We take authority over this area. As we come together in unity, there's so much power.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. I want to hinder the lawlessness. I want to hinder. I want God's people to hinder lawlessness till Jesus has to come back.
Amen.
So He can finish. So He can finish what He plans on doing. You know, the cross was finished when God said in the beginning, when He said that Satan would be crushed under the foot. When He prophesied of the coming Messiah, the cross was already finished. Though it was not done, it was spoken by the word of God. Everything that God speaks, it is already done, though it has not taken place. Hope is the substance of things. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not yet seen. It doesn't matter what you see with your eye. You speak the word of God, and it is finished. It is done. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
The only expressions that are in the earth that Christ Jesus rose from the dead and is now supremely ruling, as all the prophets prophesied, over all things. And though we do not yet see all things subject unto Him and put under His feet, I tell you, the time is certain. The space of time is certain. I'm looking forward to the new sound system where I can control everything from here. The time is certain that this one that we now have will pass away and cease to exist. So is these things concerning sin, the powers of darkness, those things that the enemy of our soul fights, unfortunately, in a very effective way to prevent. But God is set on bringing forth spiritual maturity. Everywhere we turn in the Bible, we're hearing about spiritual maturity and increase. And Father, His purpose tonight, that you lock in and you engage with Him in a relationship that brings forth spiritual maturity. And He hasn't placed a limit on it. You know, when you go and you get a new job and they'll tell you where you're basically going to reach your limit. You know, you're going, based upon your education and your background and who you are and what you can do, they'll say, well, you can grow so much in this company. You know, if you haven't asked your boss that yet, you need to. Say, where do I top out here? I promise you, he's not going to tell you, oh, about a million or two. Are you listening to me? He's probably going to tell you something that when you hear it, you're going to be shocked. And then you're going to be further shocked when he tells you how long it's going to take you to get that much. But Father has not placed any limits, no limits, on anyone for any reason. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey girl, come here. Is the speaker too loud? And you just turn, you tell him, turn it down. You gotta come up here. I'm looking all over. Say, where's my wife? Where's she at? Hallelujah. 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 I am certain that when you begin to transition over into a realm where you'll just begin to rejoice in the reality that the Spirit of the Father would speak through you, and the Spirit of, you can be confident about the Spirit of the Father speaking through you and the Spirit of the Son speaking through you, that all of a sudden you won't matter anymore. You'll get such boldness and confidence, and you'll begin to rise up in divine expressions. Tonight, in the name of Jesus, your spring turns into a river. Hallelujah. 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 And every day you can practice having your spring turn into a river. Now, I think many days we, as it were, wake up in the morning and we really more or less have a spring. Huh? But you can turn that into a river real quick. I mean, there are a lot of times I'll wake up with the river. And it's beautiful to wake up with the river. Hallelujah. Especially, you know, when you're in meetings every day. You're preaching in the morning, preaching in the evening. Huh? You're so, the power of God's so on you, when you go to bed, you barely can fall off to sleep. And then when you finally do, you wake back up. And all you're thinking about is the signs and the wonders and the miracles and the exploits that God's going to do and the purpose of the things that He wants to release through His people. My. Every word of God that is spoken is for us to be able to prosper and to be blessed. It's for us to be able to be enriched with supernatural power, to be enriched with supernatural ability, to have that which, the capacity to exceed beyond the brightest, the strongest, the mightiest. And all you and I have to do is begin to listen differently, hear differently. God, the Holy Ghost, wants to teach you how to hear. You know, it's our pathetic condition. We don't even know how to hear. Much less understand, you know. But He's here to help us. And we say, Lord, cause me to hear. Oh, God. You know, He's always talking about circumcise your ears so you can hear. Oh, God, hear. Lord, do it. I can't believe people that want to walk around uncircumcised. And anyway, it's a mess. It's a mess, a stinking mess. I want everything circumcised around me. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Oh, Teramasita Hoba Deli Hebra. Hallelujah. Praise God for the people of the Lord, the people that know their Lord, that know their God. You can be seated. Hey, I don't know. We got this book that finished. Is it on Amazon yet? Okay, so here's the final copy. Final copy is done. It's getting ready to go on to Amazon. And I think what we're going to do, it's just a little booklet. And we're doing it because we simply want there to be more exposure. That when somebody types it on Google or And because people are Google addicts. It's a new addiction. It's a modern day addiction, Google addicts. And as soon as, you know, my wife, she says, she'll ask me, say, she thinks I know everything. And so now, you know, I'm just kind of like tired of answering and thinking about it. I'll say, Google it. And then she'll scold me and I quit saying it. I'll say, okay, well, let me think about it. I know you think I know everything, but I don't. Then she tells me, oh, yes, you do. The scripture says, and you know, all okay, but anyway. But when people go on and they Google and they say, what about tongues? What is tongues? And the first thing that's going to pop up, it's of the devil. It's demonic. It's not for the day. Anybody who does, it's crazy. Stay away from those folks. Just all this other demonic stuff, lies. For which the scripture, the Bible, just taken simply as a child, as a childlike person just hearing what's being said, you're going, what? How can what God said we are supposed to have and that which ushered in the wonderful event of the Holy Spirit be something demonic? This is messed up. You need to go back. I don't know who you say you are. You said you're a doctor of theology, but whoever gave you that from whatever school, they need an evaluation. But we're gonna like post a booklet for just something really inexpensive, you know, just to be have it there like 99 cents. Everybody go buy one. I know you can go get a copy. You can say, oh, my pastor did that, I don't need to buy it. Go buy it. And then just kind of send out little messages to all of your friends. Put it on your Facebook page. If you want to know about tongues, then send it out to your whole network. There's a lot of network in here. Huh? Somebody said, I don't have Facebook. Well, you know what? Fine. If you can't handle that kind of stuff, then you just stay away. For me, nothing can, no weapon formed against me can prosper. I've got enough relationship with the Lord. Hallelujah. I'll turn away from evil. But if you can't turn away from evil yet, I can understand why you don't want any other venues. For me, it's a venue of ministry. I will preach the gospel. I want to outdo Paul. Paul was able to preach the gospel in every opportunity. I guarantee you, the Apostle Paul would have Facebook, Twitter. He would have them all. In every way, he could be preaching the gospel because that's our hearts. That's who we are as God's people. Our hearts are set on these things. Why? Because we've given over to the Spirit of the Lord. I don't have my own thing anymore.
Amen.
And tonight I pray in the name of Jesus that those of you who have your own thing and you're preoccupied with your own stuff, that tonight you get liberated.
Yes.
That tonight a moving of the Spirit takes place in your life and you get so thirsty to be a part of the group of the mighty. You get so thirsty, you get so desperate for God, like, Father, I don't want to be left out. I mean, it's one thing, you know, it's one thing to be, you know, a bench warmer. It's another thing, you didn't even make the team, man. Oh, you relegated to screaming up. You don't even have enough money for a front row ticket. You got to be up in the nosebleed section telling everybody how you could do it if you just had an opportunity. You hear what I'm saying? Come on, man. Father's given you the privilege to be involved in the greatest thing that has ever happened. Hey, hey, hey. And he sees, he looks, he's seeing how what you're doing with it. He's seeing how passionate you are with it. He hears the cries and the prayers for the desires of your heart. And what is so wonderful when the cries and the prayers and the desires of our heart is, oh, God, use me more. And it's not just, no, God, use me more, and we're sitting around doing nothing. It's God, use me more, and we're seizing every opportunity and everything that we possibly can have to preach the gospel. So I pray that you will turn, you know, listen, I mean, I don't know why you think we need to see what you're getting ready to stuff in your stomach. I don't know why you think that we need to see, you know, what's going to be metabolized by your digestive system. But I promise you, we don't want to see it. We don't want to see. You should be ashamed of showing us your, you know, your banana cream pie with double toppings. We don't want to see it. It's not what Facebook is for. Facebook came into existence so you and I could grab a hold of it and preach the gospel with it. I don't care what those ungodly people thought they were doing for, you know, for their own pocketbooks. I seize it. I take hold of it. Give me that. I mean, give me that. I'm going to use it for the kingdom. I'm going to use it for a club to beat Satan in the head with.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Give me that. Jesus. The Lord wants maturity in our life. And the way he's done it is just you and I being able to enjoy this love relationship with him. You know, we'll see all, I mean, Father, everything Father's called us to be is so far beyond any human ability, man. Just give up before you get started. He's called us to be holy as he's holy, walk in righteous as he's righteous, pure even as he's pure, to walk in his power and his authority, to glorify him in our body and our spirits, to walk in the display of his life and his ministry. You had to find something else but you. Huh? You had to find something other than yourself in order to be able to do what God's called you to do. Huh? I mean, come on. Father speaks one word. I mean, Abraham was a nobody. He was a nobody. He was nobody. Nobody knew him. Father said, points at him and says, guess what? I'm going to make you so great that all the nations of the earth will be blessed through you. And we stand in the midst of the same person tonight, the same Almighty God whose eyes go to and fro, looking for someone who you can say, I'm going to make you great.
Amen.
Come on.
You set your heart. You set your heart on me, and I've set my heart on you.
Yes.
Father wants maturity.
Yes.
He wants us to desire the sincere ministry,
yes.
The real, true, genuine ministry,
yeah.
of that which He supplied to us by the Holy Ghost and by His living, most powerful Word, where you and I get to just sit there and just enjoy his presence and talk to him and give ourselves over into a realm where we're learning to participate with something that has nothing to do with all the things that your culture has taught you to enjoy, the sense realm, to be looking at this and looking at that, and you know, all the things that go on in the under the scope of the definition of the pleasures of this world, what everybody else is entertained by and addicted by. I mean, like you take television, for example, it's addictive. It's extremely addictive. And then the way those things are designed, they're designed by very brilliant people. They're very addictive, and the way that they do it is to ultimately bring you to a place where you got to have all that stuff. And Father wants to show you and I a place, a realm, a glory, where we begin to discover those things that belong to him in such a way that we're so captivated by it that we can begin to experience things as people in the past experienced. And there's been many, just that there's, you know, we get certain examples like Mariah Woodworth Edder, who was caught away in heaven. I mean, that's a great way to spend an evening. I mean, come on, if you had the privilege of watching a John Wayne movie or going up into heaven, spend an evening in heaven, what's it going to be?
Heaven.
Huh? Well, it's going to cost you something. It's going to cost you something. It's going to cost you, all it's going to cost you is your willingness to give your valuable time to be taught of the Holy Ghost how to function in a whole nother realm.
Amen.
Amen.
Called spiritual.
Yes, Lord.
Wow. It's true. It's true. The scripture is just, this is what this is about. This is about you and I being able to see what to see with his eyes, to hear ears have never heard before and see what eyes have never seen before and understand what's ever entered the heart of men, which only God the Holy Spirit can show us. And that's what Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, you know, beginning right there at verse 8 and 9, and all the way through to verse 14, 15. And then we listen to what Jesus had to say about how that the Holy Spirit is going to come. And when he comes, he's going to cause us to recognize that the Father is in Jesus, and that Jesus is in us and that we're in him. And I need to spend some time developing in that concept and that reality. Huh? I need to spend some time getting accustomed to that way of thinking. You know, it's no problem to recognize that the Father is in Jesus or to be taught that by the Holy Spirit. And, you know, and there's more to say on that. But, you know, it really takes a little bit of time to get accustomed to really get comfortable with the reality that we're in him, yeah. And that he's in us. And I can, and it's not too hard to grab a hold of the fact that we get to be in him. Because, I mean, he's just like, you know, it's like a loving friend come and say, saying, come and stay with me. You can hang out with me. You can be with me. I got the passes to everything. Huh? You with me? It's better than having the pass. I got the pass to Sea World, to, you know, the jungle, whatever. Animal Kingdom, whatever it is. The zoo. The Lord's got the passes to all the secret realms of the divine glory. You know, we have so many people witnessing to us through the Bible of all the things that we get to do. The Lord, I mean, if the Lord expressed everything that was going on and everything that he thought and everything, you know, that took place in people's lives, I mean, the whole world would have to be a library. There wouldn't be enough paper. There wouldn't be enough ink to write it off. So the Lord, when you read the Bible, the Lord is very specific. Those are very potent words. Every one of them is filled with empowerment to prosper you, to bless you, to cause you to step over into the realms of the divine. It's a blessing and a prosperity by way of stepping into the divine that it is a doorway, an access way into. You spend some time with the Holy Spirit and he shows you that Christ is in you. Jesus said that you are in me and I am in you. And then all of a sudden you become empowered. And now with the Spirit of the Father which speaks through me. Somebody says to me, what are you going to minister about tonight? I don't know. Well, you don't look stressed or concerned. Shouldn't you be studying? No. Well, what's up with that? I'm confident that the Spirit of the Father will speak through me. Amen. That when I open up my mouth, glory is going to come out. Yes. Revelation is going to come out. Yes. Those things which only the Spirit of the Lord can say. Yes. Why should I practice about what I should say? Why should I put together some sermon that makes sense to men when Jesus didn't do one? Not one sermon did Jesus put together that made sense to anybody. I'm taking my lead from him. Hallelujah. Sounded like he's changing subjects right, left, and center and talking proverbs and parables and what did he just say? And that's how he led to everybody. What did he just say? Eat my flesh, drink my blood, no explanation other than just eat it, drink it, otherwise you're not in. I'm going with him. I'm not modeling myself after flesh. Amen. After the things that the satanic realm has designed, that which pleases men, that incites their own, you know, emotions and passion and interest. I got some stuff to talk to you about tonight. I'm trying to get there. Because I'm going to speak forth the Word of God. And when I speak forth the Word of God, those who will take a hold of it. Look, I'm going to just tell you, I know of a wonderful man of God, and he was prophesying one night to a large group of people, and I think what he had in mind was some of the businessmen, some of the people who really were pressing in the realms of prosperity. I think he had in mind that this word that the Lord had given him, because it was a certain word, that it was applied to them. But I want to tell you this because it describes how that anybody who will take a hold of it, because God hasn't just left, when God gives a general expression, he's left nobody out. People will leave themselves out. They will listen to lies. They will listen to discouragement. They will hear wrong and they will leave themselves out. But God has given a general call to anyone who will listen. Yes. And he said by the Spirit of the Lord, he said, there's going to come an event where there's three financial breakthroughs. The first one, when you have the financial breakthrough, you got to bring 100% of it to God. The second one is going to come to you, and when the second one comes, it's going to be 50-50. 50 goes to you, 50% goes to God. When the third one comes, every debt that you have will be cleared. It'll be a moment of great prosperity. And it wasn't long, and a widow that he knew very, very well, who had a huge household that she was feeding and taking care of, comes and says, Pastor, a first financial breakthrough has come. And he's like, I'm not taking her money. I'll give her money. There's no way I'm taking her money. And so he says to her, I'm not taking your money. If there's anybody I would give money to, it's you. And she says, wait a minute. I thought you were my friend. You're going to deprive me of that great breakthrough that's going to come where all of my debts are canceled and prosperity comes? And so he takes it. But he doesn't put it in the offering. He puts it in a drawer to store it for. Faithless preachers. All we're doing is delivering the word of God. We're shocked out of our mind because we'll hear the word of God, which is spirit and life, and we'll try to put it within the framework of what we think and who it applies to. Never works that way. God wants you to grow and mature. And everything that's going to happen tonight, and everything that's said tonight, and those prophetic words that go forth, you can lay hold on them. You can have them because you say they're yours.
Amen.
There's been times that the Lord, especially when I was younger and more zealous, the Lord told me, I had an impression. I say the Lord tells me, I had a strong impression to tell people to do some crazy things. And if they would do it, they would be healed. And they went and did it and they got healed. Crazy, crazy stuff. I was just going with Jesus. I didn't do spit, you know, mud. I spit a couple of times, but... You know, I didn't do spit, mud, put it in your eyes, and go wash to the ocean. But I did some stuff. And Father honored it because people were willing to lay hold on what they were willing to honor. Wherever, see, Jesus had no honor among his own people. And when the man of God is not honored, there's no way to connect with the supply of the Spirit. And whatever you do to the least of... whatever you do to his ministers right now, you do it to him. And what was going on in Nazareth happens in a lot of churches with a lot of people who they have opted out themselves, and their own attitudes have prevented the blessing and the supply of the Spirit from flowing to them. But you know, you don't want to be of that sort. You just want to in every way be conformed to the image of the Son. Listen, you know what God will do? His love will take a hold of you and make a foot washing servant out of you.
Yeah.
That's pretty radical, huh?
Yeah.
God sees me with his love and made me a foot washing servant.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. It's true. That's where all the blessings are. She brings it. She had another breakthrough. Financial breakthrough. For her, it was financial breakthrough. She brings 50% of it. Once again, the preacher took it, put it in the drawer for when she needed it. Because he had a long experience with the crisis of this widow's life and the desperation of her situation. A bank was putting pressure on her because it wasn't here in the United States of America. That in other countries, they don't have the protective laws to the individuals who've taken out loans that they have here in other countries. They were putting pressure and threatening her. Well, suddenly the bank calls her up and says to her, because her dead husband owed this huge amount of money, and said, "We're so sorry, we had it wrong. We owe you a bunch of money instead of you owing us a bunch of money." God went and changed the book. He has the right to do it. He can change the book. That's not ripping nobody off. He went and changed the book. This lady, I have all of her debts cleared. Not only she have her debts cleared, she gets a bunch of money.
Come on.
And she gets to keep 100% of that. No. The comparison of what she gave to the 100% she gave to God on the first breakthrough. Pennies. Half cent on the dollar. Huh? What God let her keep. And I love that story because it really applies to anybody. I mean, I'm sure that there was in that crew... And that crowd of people, that there were people there that were great businessmen, and they had great business deals, basically, you know, in the fire, as it were, you know, several irons in the fire of things happening. And who knows? Maybe none of them even did it. Maybe they all just thought it through and said, this is just a scheme, because they lost their honor and they lost their reverence and they lost their respect for the anointing, and they made what God does purely after the image of mortal men. They turn the glory of God into that which is the likeness of men. People do it all the time. You don't want to do that.
No.
Because it cuts you off from all the supply of heaven.
No.
Hallelujah. No. Amen. She wanted to say no a couple times, so I just helped emphasize. You don't want to do that. And, you know, this book, this little booklet on tongues, I pray that every one of you read it, you absorb it, you come to know it. So if anybody asks any questions about it. And you know, those of you who are watching me by the web, I get so many messages. I'm so thankful for the things that people tell me about how many times they listen to certain sermons. I listen to it over and over again. Some ministers, some preachers, just lay people. I mean, those of you who have already started reading this book, I've had people who I feel like they're very equipped and understanding how to express the gift of tongues, and yet they've taken this booklet already in this form that it was first posted on the web, and they've just absorbed it, and they go through it. And you know, because sometimes we'll just read and say, yeah, I know. It isn't about you knowing it, sweetie. Do you got it? Is the flow there? Are you profiting from it? Because if you say you got it and you've never interpreted tongues, you don't have it. You spend time looking. I know it's just a short little booklet. I know it's just a few verses of scripture. You need to look at it a little bit more. You need to pray over it a little bit more. You hunger and thirst after it. But I pray in Jesus' name that you just go through these various different chapters. And let me just tell you what they are. It's tongues belong to the church. A lot of people say that it's not supposed to be in the church. And we proved to you that it is in the church. And we're not using our own, you know, philosophy. It's not going to have spin here. I know everybody's having to fight the spin monster. But there's no spin here. I just give you the simple word of God. You can see yourself. Is that what it says or not? Okay? And then you just leave it there. Because if it's just what it says, then why do you want to mess with it? Huh? And that's a lot of wisdom, just to simply receive God's word for what it says and just do it. Because that's where you're going to prosper. That's where you're going to be blessed. That's where the supply of the Spirit is going to flow to you. And then, you know, the next one is baptism in the Holy Ghost, the manifestation of tongues. Don't tell me that you've been swimming if you're not wet. People always saying they're baptized in the Holy Ghost without no evidence of speaking in tongues. That's like telling me you're swimming and you're not wet. Come on, man. Jump in. Amen. What on earth? Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Praying and singing in the Spirit? What a blessed thing, you know. That's been going on here tonight. We've been praying in the Spirit and praying with the understanding, singing in the Spirit, singing with the understanding. There's already been tongues, interpretation of tongues here tonight.
Yeah.
There's been the speaking forth of the Spirit of the Lord by prophecy and exhortation. Hallelujah. What a church. I mean, that's exciting. When you come to the meeting, you think, man, tonight I'm a blow in the Holy Ghost. Tonight, I mean, I'm telling you right now, tonight my spring is turning into a river that's going to bust out. It's going to bust out. You talk about that hitting it out of the park, man, we're going to hit it out of our solar system. I mean, come on. We're taking it to another extreme. Amen. And why anybody wouldn't like this, why anybody's upset about this, it's not even reasonable. It's only reasonable from the framework of it's not normal within the realms of demon-possessed men and a world system that is anti-Christ and anti-God. There's nothing, there should be nothing about it that is reproachful when it comes to the church, because this is how the church was born. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Rushing mighty wind, clothed in tongues of fire, everybody speaking in a heavenly language, the language of the Holy Ghost, as God the Holy Ghost gave him utterance. Tongues is a language no man understands. And that's a revelation in a lot of people, because there's some people say, oh yeah, they needed tongues back in those days because nobody knew how to. They were a bunch of ignorant, stupid people, didn't have any language schools, and you know, they need to go to talk to people who, you know, they didn't know their language. And so, wait a minute. The scripture says no man understands tongues. Holla. Somebody said, well, there in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Well, 1 Corinthians chapter 13 was written by the same person who wrote 1 Corinthians chapter 14, and he didn't create a contradiction within a couple of sentences. Said, no man understands it. When he said, though you speak with the tongues of men and angels, it's just another way to say, of saying you speak with those languages that people can understand, and you speak with a spiritual language. It's just another way of saying the understanding and the spiritual. So, in a contradiction, no man can understand it. See, it's the language of men. People, I tell you, there have been those who have said that tongues, they could hear what would the tongues that somebody was speaking, they could hear it in their native tongue. I've had people say that to me. I've had people come to me and say, where did you learn how to speak Swahili? I never learned how to speak Swahili. They said, well, you were speaking Swahili and this is the things that you were saying in the meeting. Fine. And the Lord could do that miracle, but that's not what it's about. No man understands it. Hallelujah. But you know, you're not going to limit what God can do. It's just generally speaking. And then, you know, in this chapter on interpretation of tongues, I want you to get in that. Just dive into that. Say, oh, God, that's what I want. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Then just go praying in the Holy Ghost. Just tell the Lord how you want. You want to move into that realm, and the spring will turn into a river, and you'll start interpreting your own tongues right there in your living room, walking around your backyard, whatever it is. I'm telling you, right? Driving in your car. Man, you have a Holy Ghost meeting right there in your car. And then you can just bring that Holy Ghost meeting from your car into the church place, and we'll have a holy place, a glorious place, an exciting place, a big, gigantic party. Because everybody will be doing something instead of everybody standing around watching somebody work. Amen. Are you right? Are you with me?
Yeah.
Oh, man, we had a great meeting tonight. You did, yeah. We just all sat around and watched the pastor flow in the Holy Ghost, right, left, and center. He did all these things. Well, come on. That's like, you know, you going on the job and saying, you know, yeah, we got a lot done today. I mean, we got a lot of work done. You didn't do nothing. There was one person working and everybody else was watching. Hello. You have no right to claim that we got a lot of work done. You watch somebody get a lot of work done. And you don't want that. You don't want that rap. You don't want that. You want to have some fun in the place.
Amen.
Come on, man.
Amen.
Come on.
Amen.
Look, only crippled people and people that are whatever. I mean, I better be careful. I don't want to say anything too bad about people. Want to sit on the bench and watch everybody else play baseball. Anybody who's healthy wants to come on, man. It's my turn.
Yeah.
Let's have some fun. Ain't having no fun sitting there watching the program. I mean, some people have fun. So used to living vicariously. But come on, let's play. Let's do this thing. In Jesus' name. So I just encourage you, just get into this. Then the next chapter is the need for tongues. So that's a clincher. I mean, yeah. Then come, let us reason together. Hallelujah. And I got some serious points in there. Come, let us reason together. Because I described Jesus' ministry without the working of the Holy Ghost. I described Jesus' ministry with no power to demonstrate. And that's just pathetic. That's pathetic. I mean, you know. You know, Jesus says, without signs and wonders, you will not believe. And people try to make it like he was all upset about having to do signs and wonders. That is the most ridiculous conclusion. That is the most brain dead conclusion. And it's the majority of theologians have that conclusion. That Jesus was somehow put out and somehow really just, you know, overburdened and feeling, you know, used and abused because he gets to go love on people and set them free from their sickness and their disease. Give me a break. What kind of rational thinking is that? Come on. And then folks are listening to that nonsense. Don't listen to that nonsense. Come, let us reason together. Hallelujah. Come, let's just think for a minute. Let's put our little thinking caps on. Amen. Hallelujah. When Jesus said, I'm not going to preach the gospel without signs and wonders and miracles, and you can't preach on my behalf without signs and wonders and miracles, because God's ordained signs and wonders and miracles, and you're going to do these works and greater works than these.
Amen.
And somebody's fussing about him saying, come, well, and it's even in the same book. He says in John chapter 5, and then, you know, and by the time, John chapter 4, forgive me, 444, that's a 46. And then by, you know, John chapter 14, verse 12, he said, then these works shall you do in great works.
Amen.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
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 I'm doing a booklet right now. I'm just so excited about it. I just posted the first chapter of it because it's just a little booklet. I just wanted to be potent and strong and think about it on the seven miracles of John, the seven signs of Jesus that are listed in John. There's so much to say about it because all of his sermons are sent. He first does a miracle and then he centers all of his sermons and all of his revelation around the miracle that he did. And I'm not going into that part. I'm just laying it out so you can get insight on how to have wisdom to flow in the anointing, because it takes wisdom to move with God the Holy Ghost. And the only place that wisdom comes from is the Word. And if we're hungry for it, we're not going to be sitting here just trying to, you know, learn from the trees. You with me? Learn from the birds. There's a lot you can learn from birds, but this thing you're not going to learn from birds. Are you with me? You're going to go and search it out in the Word. Yeah, well, I've already read that. Well, you didn't read it good enough. You didn't read it close enough. I because I've been there. I've read it over and over again, and I didn't read it close enough. There was a time where I read the Bible because it was my religious duty. Then I started reading the Bible because I wanted to be able to argue more effectively. And then I started reading the Bible because I wanted to know Him. And then I started understanding that, wait a minute, there's the insights and the wisdom to be able to flow with Him to do His works. It's found in His Word. I want to know more about the living Word, and it's the written Word that tells me who He is. And how to move with Him. How to, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I mean, for me, that was really the onus that was placed on me to learn biblical languages, because it slowed me way, way down. Where I'm like taking every single word, and every single word is a labor to understand what it is. Because you're learning the language. Oh, I pray that you'll get this. And I pray that you will be able to profit from those things that the Lord has enriched me with. Because this is the way the program works. Somebody can labor in the Word. You can hear what they are saying out of the enrichment that came to them by the Holy Ghost, and immediately receive the full benefit of it, and might even benefit more than the person who told you. Just depends on how you hear. Huh? Be careful how you hear. Those who have ears to hear can hear what the Spirit is saying, because their heart's right, because they're desperate, they're passionate about heaven. I'm passionate about heaven. I'm not going to be getting passionate about heaven on my deathbed. I'm passionate about heaven now. I mean, you know, Paul, think about Paul. He was so captivated by the things that he was allowed to be involved in the realms of interacting with God, the Holy Ghost, instead of your pathetic job. I know it's tough, but if you quit complaining about it, I'm going to tell you right now, I've got to promote you. And all the other things that you're wishing that you had, your little boats, you know, your little rubber ducky to play with in the bathtub, because that's really all it amounts to. Where's my ducky? Where's my ducky? Because that's really all it is. It just amounts to that. All of your grown-up stuff is your little rubber duckies. And you just push that out of the way and start spending some time with God and spending some time with the realms of heaven. You'll start doing what Paul did. He said, I groan to leave this realm. I'm groaning to put off this tabernacle. I want to be done with this realm. Man, I got a glimpse of paradise. Yes. There's nothing nostalgic about this world. You get a glimpse of heaven and you suddenly realize, wait a minute, what God did in this life is beautiful and wonderful, and we praise Him for it, and we think about it, thank Him for it. But when you cast your vision and you get on heaven and you get a glimpse of that glory realm, you want, it is so far beyond anything that is here. Yeah. Yeah. Huh? Yeah. I'm going to tell you something. You live, let's just say, in kind of a modest, you know, everyday average type of a house, right? Where most people live. You know, 8-foot ceilings, you know. Paint in some sort of condition. You know, the stains, and you live with the stains and the chips, right? Especially if you have kids. You go and you spend some time in a palace where everything is marble, and there ain't no paint and there ain't no chips. Everything is marble and wood carvings and stone carvings, and it's opulent. I mean, it's on the level of like gold trim, real gold. Silver everywhere. The chandeliers aren't made out of brass. That's not brass. That's not tin. That's actually silver. You stay there. Stay there for a while. You won't go back to your shack. And if you get back there, you're going to go, this is pathetic. You're going to want to be remodeling. Listen, and it is just a weak description of what you and I can be participating with. Thank you. I got one true. Three giggles. Four, what on earth is he talking about? There's a heavenly realm. There's a realm of the spirit that's more real than the realms of the natural. It's more real than the realms of the natural. It's more real because it's eternal. This is temporal. That's why I say it's more real. It's eternal. This is temporal. What is seen and what you captivated your attention is temporal. And God wants us to get our affections over in the unseen realm, where we look upon our desire, not what is seen, but that which is unseen, that which is eternal, that which belongs to this place where if we're hungry for it and thirsty for it enough, all of a sudden we'll get to step into what Elisha stepped in, where he could see it.
Amen.
You see, what are you talking about? You realize how many are on our side right now? There's more with us than are with them. What are you talking about? Lord, open up his eyes so he can see. The heavens filled with the angels of the Lord. They're all around us. Where did they come from? Well, they've been here all the time. You're kidding me. Yeah, you didn't have the perception to be able to notice. Your senses weren't exercised. You don't have the perception yet. You've valued other perceptions. I praise God for the ability to see. I love being able to see. Thank you, Father, I can see. We woke up this morning was so beautiful. Every day is beautiful. You know, you wake up. It's so beautiful. But I've seen something even more beautiful. You have to have your senses exercised in order to be able to perceive it. And Father wants to bless you with this. But you've got to get over all this stuff. This Satan, the demonic realm, constantly is working to utilize, to blind you, to dull your senses. You've got to wise up. You've got to shape up and wise up. Shape up in the Holy Ghost. Wise up in the Word of God.
Yes.
Recognize that He has consecrated us and He's set us apart to be able, so that we can be taught of God. So that, as Jesus said in John chapter 16, that the Holy Spirit will take everything that belongs to the Father, that belongs to the Lord Jesus, and He will reveal it to us. That is huge. That is huge. Everything. Everything. What? How do I? Then the next question should be, how do I do that? He says, sit down here and let me talk to you. My concern is that there's not a lot of people that got real with God in the dialogue and said, well, how do I do that? I want to understand how to receive that. I want to sit down, I want to understand how to move in that, to have that knowledge, to perceive that. To profit from that, to benefit from that. Mm-hmm. He's here to do it. He's here to do it tonight. We're not just talking about these things just to pass the time. We're declaring these things because Father is looking for somebody to say, that's what I want. This is what He's already declared. This is no new revelation. This isn't say, listen, I just heard a word from God. Here, take this on. I'm giving you the scripture telling you what God said, that anyone who wants can lay hold on that and say, that is real. Yes. That is mine. Yes. I want to learn.
Yes.
And a big part of that that the Lord blessed us with is this place of building up ourselves in the most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Huh?
Yeah.
Paul said, I pray in the Holy Spirit. I pray in the Holy Ghost, the language of the Spirit, the spiritual realm, more than all of you. Think about it, because we think, well, you know, man, I got in 30 minutes and I'm worn out. Man, I tell you, I feel like I really accomplished something. We prayed in the Holy Ghost 30 minutes today. Wait. That should have been a refreshing to you over here.
Amen.
That shouldn't
Amen.
Wore you out. That should be the place that you run to. Let me go over here. I'm hurting. I'm feeling discouraged. I'm feeling a little bit concerned. I'm feeling a little doubtful, a little bit overwhelmed. Let me run over here. And the Lord did, with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. See, the same one that said, I'll pray in the Spirit and pray with the understanding also is the same one who gave us that verse of Scripture in Ephesians, we'll pray in the Spirit. He didn't change His definition on us, moving things around. You with me?
Yeah.
Come on. We're praying in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication.
Amen.
Watching thereunto. Hallelujah. With all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Making your requests known unto God.
Amen. Thank you.
Father, I thank you that this church and the people in this church, you guys could come and sit down. Josh, we might have to stay. I thank you, Father, that the people in this church, oh, you can come sit by your wife. She's about to deliver. John Samuel is about to come forth. And in the name of Jesus, not to be imprisoned by a culture of designed by Satan and adopted by men, whose life becomes nothing more than imprisoned by the way that men think and enslaved by the things that men desire. But his life and his affection. I mean, Elijah had nothing. The Tishbite had nothing. Amen. You know, he owned two items. Huh? He had a camel skin kind of robe and a leather belt. So far as we know, he didn't even have shoes. But he had everything. He could get translated from one place to the other. He could call fire down out of heaven. He could pray and it would not rain. He was in charge. What would you hear that? A bunch of little boats and grown up adult rubber duckies. You know what I'm saying? Or be able to command the rain and it not rain. And command the rain and it rains. And to be translated from one place to the other. And hear God audibly speak and command fire to come out of heaven. And be God's ambassador on the earth in his stead. To be caught up to the Lord. To not just have a visitation in heaven like Moriah would with Eder. He'd been standing there in the presence of God for like 2,500 years. Forgive me, 2,700 years. What's that like? I'd like to go check him out and see what he's doing right now. One like, what is he still hanging out in camel's hair in leather girdle? I bet. I bet you he is. I bet you he's going to come back just like that. Because I think he's just like, you know, just. Because it's so beautiful. It's just like for the first 2,700 years, you're going, trying to say something, but nothing's coming out. Can you do overwhelmed with the glory? I've experienced the glory. I know what it's like. I just scratched the surface and I know what it's like. It's shocking. It's overwhelming. I begin to get understanding what the seraphims were doing when they were covering their face. It wasn't just respect. They couldn't handle looking. It was too glorious. It was too overwhelming. It was too much to bear. And then they, you know, after a trillion years, they said, let's take a peek. And they go, ah! It's beautiful. It's wonderful. It's too much to see. Oh, my. And I'm not putting on a show. And I'm not acting something out. I'm not trying to be entertaining. I'm not an entertainer. Of course, that doesn't come as a surprise. I'm just telling you what's been revealed to me, what God has made real to me, what I've seen, what I've begun to touch, what I've tasted of. And I'm pursuing it, and I'm passionate about it, and I pray that you will pursue these things too, because it's a heavenly people whose minds are set upon heavenly things, who hunger and thirst after a heavenly realm that are going to bring heaven to the earth.
Amen.
Praise God. When Jesus stepped in, anointed and baptized in the Holy Ghost, he brought heaven into the earth. People had never seen heaven. Heaven broke out upon them at the pool of Bethesda. All they knew was to have faith in an angel that stirred the water. Jesus stepped in and brought heaven to them. To the worst and the most pathetic cases. I guarantee you, after Jesus got finished ministering to the man who was laying there for so many years, that there was nobody left at the pool of Bethesda when he was done. I promise you. The scripture said there was a great multitude of sick and impotent people there. But I promise you, when the worst case was healed, they all left the pool and followed the Redeemer. Did you see what he did for, you know, so-and-so? The guy was so worthless that nobody would help him. He was the guy that nobody wanted to be around. The guy's worthless. He stinks. Who knows? He was no account. Nobody. Poured out his complaint. There's nobody to help me. Maybe he was thinking at that moment in time that Jesus was volunteering. That he was going to stay by his side. Like, you're the first person that's talked to me like in 20 years. I'm true, I'm true, I'm true in this situation. When everybody saw the love and the mercy of God poured out on this pathetic person, I'm telling you right now, there was no more pool of Bethesda. He was emptied out because faith had been revealed. Life, healer, heaven. Father has made you and I the revealers, the carriers of this divine power and glory. Something that is realized, not through our efforts and not through our struggles, but through this intimacy and relationship where you begin to so fall in love with him and just so embrace his love and just so excited about his manifest presence that you just become perfect in obedience because you love him. Amen. Those who love him, obey him. Amen. Because love works obedience. I mean, you know. Amen. So I just pray tonight. I pray that you'll seize the divine opportunity that God has placed before you. And yeah, you may be contending for certain things. You may be battling certain things in the realms of laying hold of the expressions of divine gifts and spiritual and supernatural expressions. Maybe, you know, physical healing, maybe, you know, financial things, whatever it may be. The bottom line of it is the one who speaks and it all changes is right here in your midst. And all he's got to do is look at you and say, I'm going to make you great. And it's done. It's over. I'm going to bless you. And I'm going to tell you right now, everything around you, everything, all the rocks in your backyard turn into gold. Just turn into gold. Your gravel in your front yard, diamonds. And I mean, the gravel in your driveway, all diamonds. I mean, how hard is it for the Lord to do that? I mean, that is just, it's kind of like a, you know, somewhat of a wild example, but it's certainly a possible example. But it certainly is a description of what Father will do in every area of your life. You just got to turn over to this place of looking to him and loving on him and finding all that you want and all that you desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want. You're all I desire. And when that, really just nurture that. You let that begin to be developed in your life. And everywhere it's challenged, you go, you just sing out louder. Everywhere it's challenged, you just sing out louder. You know, and Abraham didn't even do that much. The bottom line of it is, you and I get to function in the capacity that Father has allowed us to. And he wants to allow us more because he's not placed a limitation on us. He's working with us to be able to receive. He's developing us in such a way where it won't destroy us. He's wanting to perfect everything that concerns us. He's wanting to prepare us unto every good work. He just wants us to get our attention and come over and be in the school and sit down and listen. Because, you know, it's like sometimes they think that the Lord's got a whole classroom of ADDs. Can anybody hear what I'm saying? Did anybody get that last thing I just said? And everybody's going, what did he say? What is he saying now? And the Lord is so long-suffering, and he's so patient, and he's so merciful. And hallelujah. He just sends to us the Holy Ghost who just gives forth these utterances that we get to flow in, and we get to be built up in, and we get to be strengthened in. And God just supplies to us all these wonderful things, bypassing our thinking about it. Because you think too much about it, you're going to mess it up.
True.
That's why the Lord always tells people things at the last minute. don't tell them, don't mess it up. Just surprise them. Oh, I want to get to the place of partnership with the Lord that he says that and I can faithfully do it. Come on, people. Come on, this is what the Lord wants to bring us into. The Lord wants to make this church, make our lives such a lighthouse to this nation. He wants to make the expressions. He wants us to be so comfortable around the end that people aren't sitting there looking like, you know, that somebody's getting ready to, you know, hand in the mic and they're going to speak to 10,000 people and they don't have anything to say. And they're all fearful and intimidated. Father wants you to relax. He wants you to relax. He wants you to be so overwhelmed with his peace that nothing can disturb you. You're just comfortable. He wants you to get so drunk in the Holy Ghost that you think you know everything. Somebody ask your opinion, and you're able to just give it, as it were. But you're over and around where God, the Holy Ghost, expressing His mind and His heart. It's a different kind of drunk. It's not a drunk that's that is accessing your imagination and exaggeration. Ha! Who is a rupate, a drunk in the Holy Ghost, where now God gets to speak through you, the Spirit of the Father. I have the Spirit of the Father speaking through me. And you know, He said, don't take thought for what you shall say. But in the same hour, it will be given to you because it's the Spirit of your Father speaking. I got the Spirit of the Son speaking, crying, Abba, Father. God is my dad. Papa's here right now. He's looking. He's walking around heaven bragging on me. Hallelujah. And you need to be able to see that too. Because there is a great empowerment, huh? When you know that you're loved. There's a great empowerment. When somebody's not looking over your shoulder, criticizing every move you make. Huh? Just let it get the job done, let it get it finished, and then the Lord's going to work that out. He's going to say, listen, you could have done that in half the time. I'll just let you do it. I'll let you go. But actually, what just took you 10 hours, you could have done in 10 minutes. And you go, what? No way. He said, no way. He says, way. Let me show you. Then we become really interested. I want you to look at a couple of verses of Scripture with me here, just emphasizing the empowerment of God's Word, the empowerment, the blessing of His Word, His intent in everything that He's doing, what's behind, the purposes behind, and even His correction. And I don't know that there is any, I'm going to give you two verses of Scripture that I believe should be very familiar to you, that, and they're very empowering, but maybe you've never really considered the context. And these two verses of Scripture are found in Jeremiah, in the midst of the most severe judgment and chastisement that he is having to put upon a people who refuse to hearken, who refuse to obey. I mean, they're not just not showing up for the meeting. They didn't just not show up for the meeting. They put idols in the church place. They put idols in the meeting place. And they left their idols in the meeting place in God's holy place and went out and worshiped idols in the groves instead of showing up for the meeting. So this is pretty, but yet hear God's mercy and hear His love. So open up your Bibles, and I'll open up her Bible. I'm going to open up this bigger Bible. I want a big Bible tonight. Hallelujah. I want a big word of God. Hallelujah. I don't know, small words, big words. Hallelujah. And seize the word of God, what Father has for me. I want to lay hold on this wonderful pleasure of interacting with Him. So it's not some kind of chore or obligation or something to distract me from my other real interest. You know, well, I've got to break away from my other real interest to go spend some time doing something that is not very exciting and my heart's not really in, called prayer. And prayer has been misdefined and is not understood. It needs to be a place of fellowship and talking with His Father and enjoying His presence. Amen. A place of enjoying His presence is a place of learning how to flow in the gifts of the Spirit. A place of learning how to do miracles. A place of receiving strength and empowerment. Of remembering what my place is and who I am. To be comforted. Amen. To be empowered. That's what this the ministry of the Spirit is supposed to be. And tonight I pray in the name of Jesus Christ, you seize your divine opportunity. Yes. Yes. And quit letting Satan lie to you and quit letting affections misplaced distract you. Don't have affections on things of this earth. It's a distraction. Set your affections on the things of the heavenly realm, the place of divine power and authority that you and I have. We're seated together with Jesus at the right hand of the Father. Set your affections there at the right hand of the Father where Christ Jesus is seated, where you and I are seated together with Him. Amen. And watch what Father will begin to reveal to you. So look it with me here in Jeremiah chapter 9. You know, wow, I opened up to Jeremiah 29. So I'm going to start there. I love that. Jeremiah 20. No, I had already opened up to that. I was thinking I supernaturally opened it. I did it. Go to Jeremiah chapter 9. If I would have supernaturally opened up, I promise you I'd have started there. Huh? But I remembered that I had opened it up on the pulpit, and you know, I'm gonna make sure because I checked, you know, I'm gonna flow with the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
It's easy to flow with the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
Peace is a language.
Amen.
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 Faith is sight, ability to see. Hallelujah. It's a different sense realm. Praise God.
Praise God.
Oh, when you step out to do it all in God and not in you, Father will be able to lead you. When you step out to do it in you and hope God shows up, who knows what's going to happen? Are you with me? Because that's not faith. Are you with me? Oh, God showed up tonight. You were surprised. I'm amazed. Do you get the dialogue?
Yes.
I'm amazed that there would be anything, any product of doubt and unbelief. You with me?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Now, sometimes being around me, as I said this morning, things will get messy. Because I'm going to get into those things that are going to break open, if you're willing to hear, that are going to break open a release and a supply of the Spirit to come to you. So sometimes we got to get into some serious things that you don't want nobody touching. You don't even talk about it. I don't talk about it. Now we're going to talk about it. We're going to break you out that shell right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. You know what the Spirit of the Lord said to me? To tell you? You ready for this?
Yeah.
Spirit of the Lord spoke to me today after I got home and somebody had posted the face dream for this morning's meeting. And here's what the Lord said. He says it's a time change. Spring forward. God said it's a time change.
Amen.
He says for you it's a time change. God said for you it's a time change. Spring forward. And faith grabs hold of it and said, oh, wow, it is a time change. I'm springing forward. Guess what? I sprung forward. Otherwise, you know, you can just say, well, you know, well, that's pretty cool. I thought that was pretty cool. It was pretty catchy. And you can just take it as the word of men and you will not profit. But if you'll take it as it is indeed the word of God, then you will profit from it. That's what Paul's saying to the church at Thessalonica. How did they know at church at Thessalonica, really, that Paul, you know, who they said was mighty in letters, but his presence was like, what? You know, he's like, you know, he didn't seem to be very, you know, convincing in presence. How did they really know for sure that he was speaking the word of God? He said, when I spoke to you, received it not as the word of men, but as the word of God. And as a result, it worked within you with the divine power of God. It worked with divine energy, the divine energy. Hallelujah. The profit of it, the results of it, the fruit of it. So, you know, once again, that is coming back to a place where everything is redefined for us. We don't judge after the natural thinking. We don't see after the natural eye. We know things not after the natural, but after the Spirit. We don't know men after the natural, but after the Spirit. We give ourselves over to the spiritual realm to understand things from the perspective of what God has created and what He has made and what the Holy Ghost has empowered us to do. And if you don't believe God, the Holy Ghost has empowered somebody else to speak His words and flow in the realms of prophecy and tongues and interpretation tongues, because you need proofs, you're never going to flow there because you're a prisoner of doubt and unbelief. Oh, you need substance and proof. Well, we know where your heart's at. And there's not going to be any proof. You know all you're going to get, huh, is the proof of, as Noah, I mean, forgive me, as Jonah, yeah.
Yeah.
Was in the belly of the whale. I mean, that's, you know, basically it. So shall the Son of Man be in the earth 3 days and three nights. I mean, you know, you, the Lord's going to say, listen, I've already provided all the proofs. I'll give you the proof. I'll give you the proof in the cross and the resurrection. Amen. But you can't believe that I'm able, Father says all the time, you know, He's saying, you can't believe that I'm able to bring to pass and to supply those things that I promised in my word. What do you think, that my church doesn't exist anymore? You think that somehow that the effectiveness of the moving of my power and my spirit isn't available? You think that that which I have decreed is not established? You think that I have spoken something and it did not come to pass? Hello, wake up. That's what Papa says. And then that's got to be our response. Because if it isn't, if we're always just saying, you know, well, I just don't agree with that and didn't understand that. And I'm seeing how if that was God, how he would do that. I'm going to tell you right now, most of the things that God is doing, you wouldn't agree with. From a natural perspective of your reason and your understanding, it's far beyond. It goes way beyond. Surpasses anything that you know or can think or can ask. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And you know, men, there's nothing about the natural mind that can receive anything that God is doing. The things of the Spirit are foolishness. It doesn't make any sense. Foolishness doesn't make any sense. It's meaningless. It's senseless. Do you hear what I'm saying to you? Because it's just like the cross. It's senseless. It doesn't mean anything. What do you mean? It's a place of defeat and shame. And it's a failure and end. And it's catastrophe. It shows where men are stronger than God. Almost you could, if he was God, then men were stronger than God. No, you're seeing from a natural perspective. Well, if you could see in the realms of the Spirit, you could see that was the greatest, that was the greatest moment and day of all creation, of all eternity, where Jesus single-handedly, having left his body, destroyed all the powers of darkness, spoiled all principality and power, vanquished death. As Paul said, abolish death. I love that. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Do you know how many people sit around and God speaks and he gives words and they say, well, I don't agree with that. I'm going to do it my way. Do you know how many people do that? And it has become a common thing for them. Well, I don't agree with that. And it's almost subconscious. They've so not agreed with anything other than what they have come to the conclusions and understanding of, that they literally have cut off all that Father wanted to supply to them in the supernatural blessings of divine provision that would result in our spiritual maturity. Because there needs to be maturity. There needs to be people who know how to flow in the gifts of healing greater than what you know now, who know how to prophesy with a more rich utterance of the Spirit and a more accurate expression of the will and the heart and the passions of God. And we can go on and on in the revelation of the person of who Jesus is. Because without you and I doing it, without Jesus being revealed in the midst of the church, there is no revelation of him. Because he has made us partners, co-inheritors with it. I mean, you know, he's given us his great blessing. But with this great blessing comes a great responsibility. With this great gifting comes a great responsibility. It's wonderful to jump around and say, I'm heir with God, co-inheritor with Jesus. But do you realize the value of that, meaning of that? Means that he's not going to be revealed unless you let him be revealed through you. Our participation with the things, the details of what God is saying. And reality of it is, I think in many respects, we haven't even gotten to the details yet. There's just a general overview that we're refusing to accept and cooperate with. And Father is begging us, and he's petitioning us, and he's pleading with us. He's saying, I want to do something supernatural. I want to do something miraculous through you. I want you to enjoy this relationship. I want you to enjoy the thrill of moving in that which I've empowered you to be, rather than being intimidated because you got to tell somebody about Jesus. Rather than being all fearful because you're stumbling over every tooth in your mouth trying to tell somebody your testimony. Goodness gracious, help us, Jesus. Just tweet. I mean, there's got to be a radical. Hallelujah. God says, it's a time change. Spring ahead. That's what Papa said. Man, when he said it to me, if you were watching on Facebook, I posted that after church. I made that the title of the face stream. And I take it from, I just like, thank you. I'm taking that. Yes. I mean, there's many things that have come out of my mouth that I'm preaching. I'm going, I'm getting excited about it. I'm taking that. I'm laying hold of that. I go home and say, that's mine. Amen. I don't know if anybody else besides me and a couple of other people grabbed a hold of it. But, you know, you don't want to be left out. Amen. Every word of God is for you. It's for your profit. It's for your blessing. It's for you to be able to receive those things that he miraculously supplies. Because God's not going to do it without his word. He speaks it and it comes to pass. He speaks it and the Holy Ghost takes it and runs with it and supplies all heaven's divine power and glory to you. But you've got to be able to agree. You have to agree with God. And you got to say it's mine. You say I want. You got to say I want that. I'm gonna have. I lay hold on that. I'm gonna move in that. Hallelujah. And the Lord sometimes He'll speak same thing to us over and over and over again. You grab it and you'll mature in it. Because there was a time in my life where I'm like, you know, I'm preaching tonight. I'm in this place or that place or doing this thing or that. Oh Lord, what am I going to preach on? What am I going to minister on? And it's just almost like it was starting to become a pressure. And I'm like, hold up. What's this? Forget the pressure. It's the Spirit of the Father that is speaking in me. Come on, let's have some fun over here. We can have a supernatural time over here. What are we talking about? Getting all on pressure, starting to think too hard about the thing. Messing the whole program up. We're losing the thrill and the excitement and the fun here. Huh? Trying to do something for God. And you know, we grow in it. We mature in it. God wants you to grow. He wants you to desire the sincere nourishment. Hallelujah. It's being supplied, spiritual nourishment being supplied to us by the Word of God so that you may grow. That you may mature. Hallelujah. He wants to thoroughly furnish you so that you can be thoroughly supplied and mature. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord Jesus. This is an amazing verse of scripture I'm going to read to you. Because the reality of it is people have made so many things other than what I'm talking about right now. God, His rich supply, His divine provision, the results of interacting with them, Him, they're a boast. They get all excited. You know what happened? I just won the lottery. Oh, do you know what just happened? I just got a promotion. Do you know what just happened? They just gave me the employee of the year award. Did you know what just happened? I just won the talent show or whatever. You know, the boast. I mean, I've had some interesting news reports lately of what people were excited about that happened in their life, and it became their song. Is what they sang. It became the joy and the delight of their heart. Father wants to change all of that. He wants you to begin to see what He's doing so that He becomes your song.
Yeah.
He becomes your song. Not religiously, like He's your song because you just hit the, not their mother load of gold, the Father load of glory. He becomes your boast. Not because you have to, but because something's happening in your life. The supply of the Spirit has come. You wake up in the morning with His likeness. You stand in awe of His presence. I'm experiencing the presence of the Lord. I was a friend of mine back in, you know, the early 2000s. And we'd get on the phone and I would start talking to him. I'd say, I'd say something like, because it was true. I'd say something like, you know, I've been under such an intense glory of the presence of the Lord for the past 4 days. I've hardly been able to speak. I said, a lot of times it's an effort to even see. Sometimes I don't even know how I'm driving kind of thing. And he'd say on the other line, me too. And then he began to describe what was going on. Just being able to see us to the Lord because of your song. You're like, wow, there's this heavenly communion going on. There's this overwhelming presence of God. I'm almost incapacitated to be able to do everyday or ordinary things. Hallelujah. That's a good song to sing. That's a good thing to glory in. That's a good thing to boast in. You're not having problems dealing with temptation when you're so overwhelmed by the presence of God, you feel like you're on fire. You feel like you're melting. I mean, you feel like it's just glorious. It's joy unspeakable and full of glory. It's the hand of God so powerfully upon you. It feels like you're being electrocuted, but in a good way. It's just like it's a shock that tickles. It's an electrocution that tickles. It feels good. It excites every one of your cells. It's almost indescribable. I try to describe it. It's like this electrocution that's causing you intense joy and intense peace and intense love all at the same time, and you're feeling it on a level that you never felt before, and it's continuing to increase, and it's got you totally distracted from everything that's going on. You're going, what's happening to me? This is not wild, wonderful.
Yeah, hallelujah.
It really does. It puts a silence the lies of Satan and the temptations of the enemy and all that other stuff.
Amen.
And I pray that you'll start living in it.
Amen.
There's a there's a way to live in this. There is a way to live in this joy unspeakable and full of glory. And then all of a sudden, the scripture isn't mythical to you. It is not superstitional or fictional to you. It's an expression of, oh, that's what I'm feeling. This is amazing. And now you're getting a report from God of what's happening to you.
Yeah.
You're reading the scripture, oh, I understand now. And the word is not only a confirmation and explanation of the supernatural things that God is doing in you, but it is the seed by which God then is able to supply that which is supernatural, that which is heavenly, that which is wonderful. That's which peace that passes understanding, where your spring becomes into a river. Think about it. What if you decided, I'm going to be devoted every day for my spring to turn into a river? I mean, I tell you, I felt some people grab that just now. I mean, I tell you, I felt that. I felt that. I felt that. That is good. That is good. That is God. And your participation too. That's God and your participation. Because there's many times that I've had that same virtue go out of me and it wasn't received. And it's upset. I would get totally upset. What? And I feel a release of the divine glory and no one's receiving it. And it's just like, you got to be kidding me, man. Let me kick a chair or something. This is not even right. I tell the Lord, I said, Lord, you know what? I'm not in the framework of just my own growth and maturity. I'm not going to wrestle people down to the ground, open up their mouth, and make them drink. It's an unsightly situation. I'm done with this thing. Wrestling people to the ground, trying to get them blessed. Huh? We have a squeeze for a cow. And we need that. Because otherwise, it'd be a terrible thing if we didn't have a squeeze. And we run around chasing a cow trying to get the job done. And I'm afraid that too much of my ministry has been like that, you know. So I said, Lord, look, I'm just going to flow in the Holy Ghost. I'm going to flow in the anointing. If people receive it, fine. When you want me to rebuke, you just bring it. And I'm going to not draw back, but I'm not going to belabor the thing.
Yes.
I'm just saying this to you because, you know, you need to grow up too, and you need to mature too.
Yes.
You need to recognize there's a supply from heaven coming to you that God has placed within the church, a supply to perfect you, a supply to mature you, a supply to build you up. It supersedes, it goes far beyond anything that men could try to limit to. I can't shut it down if I wanted to because I'm not greater than God. I'm not more powerful than Him. He's going to get what He's decreed and what He's purposed. And when you can have confidence in who God is and what it is He's doing, then all of a sudden you're going to be able to yield and receive and the supply of the Spirit that God wanted to come to you, flow to you. And in this, I mean, I'll tell you right now, it becomes church becomes the most joyful, the most exciting. It's like, is it church tonight yet? No, it's on a Tuesday night. Oh, man, I thought it was Wednesday night. I just can't wait. It becomes the most exciting. It becomes the most exciting place on earth. If people would just realize, people don't get it. As I was talking about this morning, you look at the dedication of the man who was there, whether he was a paralytic or whether he was just so weak from his sickness. 38 years he was in that state, and for a long time, Jesus knew by spirit knowledge that he had laid there because he had a focus on an angel that would stir the water. His whole faith was in the stirring of the water. Here we are in something far greater, and how many Christians are literally going to come and lay down in the church? How many Christians with their ailments and with their pains and with their problems would have any kind of an expression that could hold a candle to that man who is impotent? Think about it. Because God has placed in this church the miracles. It's placed here. It's resident.
Amen.
It's just here.
Yeah.
He's decreed it. It's got to be here. Because he can't lie. And if this is the church, then where is the church?
Right. Yeah.
This is the church.
Yeah.
We're part of the church.
Amen.
Praise God. This is this church.
Amen.
He's proving it over and over again. His miracles is in the house. His healing's in the house. He placed it in the house. It's in the house. Because the church is the manifestation of the person of Jesus Christ in the earth. It's there. It's a resident glory. And if people would just give themselves to waiting upon the moving of the Spirit of the Lord, knowing that not an angel's come, but Christ Jesus is walking around in the supply that he's decreed will be effective in their life. Thanks, the dynamics of people's lives would change. It's true. It would change. It would change. I said it would change. It's so sad to me. It's sad to me. People come. They've got. They have. They come one time. One time. That's it. Once. Once. And they say they're serious about the healing power of God. Where do you think the healing of power of God is located at? Surely, yes, you can get healed in the highways, in the byways. Surely you can get healed, pressing in, laying hold of God, no matter where you're at. But I'm going to tell you right now, there is a faith in the church. There's a provision in the church. There's a glory in the house that doesn't exist anywhere else that will break you out of whatever that's holding you back. It will break you out of whatever doubt and unbelief has imprisoned you. We need to get more, we need to get as, almost like I want to say, we need to get as much faith about who Christ Jesus is in the midst of his church as the man had about an angel that could stir the water. Some say it was once a year. That's once a year. And that he missed it 38 years. That's fine. I can understand that. It says something. I don't know that that's true. But I mean, if you were just there waiting, one moving of God, one moving of God. Oh, it just takes one moving of God. There's only going to be one this year. There's only going to be one, and I don't want to miss that opportunity. My. What heaven would get excited. Father would be jumping up and down saying, I got a people in the earth. Watch out. We're getting ready to bring it. I got some folks that I can flow through. I got some people that the manifestation of my power and all that my son purchased for them can now begin to be manifest through them. Father is looking for those us who will cooperate with him, who will move with him, who allow his word to be effective in our life, who will come under his training, who will put him first. And those things which he's doing, they will call it done. They will give themselves completely and wholly over to that which Father has decreed. Because if you really believe, if we really believe that he's going to do all of these things through us, that this is an opportunity that is really ours, then we would divest ourselves of all other interests and pursue this alone, because there's no greater prize. There's no greater privilege. There's no greater opportunity. I mean, and that's what we're going to do.
Yes.
Hallelujah. That's what you're going to do. Hallelujah. I'm excited about these things. Hey, it's a time change. Spring forward. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Rabbo Sedekis. Amande. Shoo. Let me just quickly read this verse of scripture to you. Real quickly. Hallelujah. And you know, when you think about God saying this in the midst of such chastisement, in the midst of such disobedience, in the midst of such rebellion, in the midst of of such obstinance. It even makes the sound of it even greater. It makes the anxiousness of God to do it even more tangible to us, that He's waiting to do it, that this is what He has for His covenant people. Everything that He had for His covenant people was over the top. It was greatness on every scale. It was the head and never the tail. It was to give us great wealth and prosper us and make us above all the other nations, more prosperous than any person on the earth. More blessed than anybody, where anybody, didn't matter who they were, they would look at you and they would faint because of the blessing in your life. They go, my goodness, your family is blessed. Everything about you is blessed. The favor of God rests upon you. Your face shining. Be this glory. I just got to have that.
Amen.
I just got to have that. When I read the verse of scripture, your seed shall be mighty in the earth, I said, that is mine. I heard it. I felt it. It's mine. I wasn't reading about something that was happening to somebody else or something that somebody else got to do or whatever. It was not misapplied. It was perfectly applied. I said, it will be mine. Hallelujah. I pray that that's what you'll do with God's word. You'll quit being rejected, dejected, cut out, shut out, left out. You'll start being included. You'll be at center of the table. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You'll recognize how God comes and takes you, and there is all these other people who did far more than you did, who accomplished far more than you accomplished, but the intimacy that you had with Him resulted in Him grabbing you and setting you at the table right by His side and putting you always at the honored position in His house. It's true.
Thank you, Lord.
Think about it. It's true. It's true. I mean, the Lord's had that exposed to me. I've seen it. I've partaken of that. I've been a recipient of that favor of God resting upon our lives. And tonight, Father wants you to grab a hold of that so that His favor can rest upon you. You don't have to play pretend no more. You don't have to wonder anymore. You don't have to feel somehow that it passed you by, that another blessing slipped through your hands. Another opportunity slipped through your hands. Because you didn't understand the day of your visitation. God wants you to be mature. He wants you to grow so that you understand all the movings of God, so that you can move with Him. Ooh. When I can understand the movings of God, I doubt that Jesus has ever been to the pool at Bethesda. I doubt He had ever been there. But by the Spirit knowledge, He went there that day to where that whole thing came to an end. He came there to touch one man's life. He came with the key to touch the multitudes. And all that Spirit knowledge results in the same impact and the same work in our lives today. We've got to shut down everything else that would distraction, that would run interference with that Spirit knowledge, with our ability to discern, with our ability to hear. Hallelujah. The love will grab a hold of you and make a foot washing serving out of you.
Amen.
You're getting ready to get promoted into being servant of the all. Hallelujah. You're getting ready. You're getting ready to be promoted into humility and meekness and brokenness. You're getting ready. And all the things that belong to God. Verse 24. Thus says the Lord, let not the wise man boast and sing and be happy, you know, in his wisdom. You know, people that are wise and they're rich and they're powerful, they have a boldness and a confidence about them. They can even be almost on the level of scary. They're just so bold, so confident. It's like they don't need anything. They don't need anybody. They don't need anybody to approve of them or anything. You know what I'm saying? You know what I mean? You've ever been around really wealthy people, people who have achieved the highest things academically, you know, it's a different state. And so the Lord's really picking this out among all the people of Israel who are missing out, and then also talking to the people that aren't missing out, who have an opportunity, who love the Lord and are willing to obey Him. Because in the midst of this situation, there was a Daniel. in the midst of the situation. Yes. Huh? There was a Jeremiah. There was a Baruch. Yes. And they were just examples of many others that were right here in the midst of this. The three Hebrew children that we love to talk about, who was not willing to bend a knee or bow to anything, sold out to God in the midst of all of this. See, not just talking to a disobedient group of people who won't obey. He's also talking about some people who are consecrated to Him. Dedicated, fiercely dedicated, fiercely devoted. Let not the wise man glory in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man glory in his might. Let not the rich man glory in his riches. No more does the wise man have a song in his mouth because he's wise. No longer does the mighty man have a song to sing and a boast to give and a misplaced confidence because he's mighty. No longer the rich singing the songs of his rich and being comfortable and secure in his riches. But let him that glory in this. Let him that boasts and is excited and got a song to sing and something to be confident about, be confident in this, that he understands and knows me. Amen. To understand and know. Amen. And this is what the Holy Spirit has come to train us in and to teach us in and to develop us in as we're sitting here tonight in this meeting, as tomorrow as we get alone with the Lord in a prayer meeting, as we begin to worship Him and sing, even in just worshiping and singing in the shower. Huh? But let it move on out of the shower and go on into the bedroom and go from the bedroom on into the living room. Get the praise in your mouth even in the kitchen. Hallelujah. Get the praise. When you get in the car, and let there be praise. Let there be walk into the place. We would say, hey, good morning. Yeah, it is. Praise God. Yeah. Amen. And there's a love and an affection that God puts in your mouth towards Him. It's good to see you. I'm glad you're here this morning. Amen. I'm glad God kept you safe this weekend, even if they're full of the devil. I'm glad God kept you safe this weekend because that's the truth.
Yeah, it is true.
And they might be going, why? You allowed to say that here? Whatever, it doesn't matter. You get to be you now. You're not ashamed of being you, who God made you. You confident. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You more than own the place. The owner of the place come in and say whatever he wants to say, do whatever he wants to say. He owns it. Huh? And that's his boast. And that's why he feels so free to do whatever it is he has in mind to do. But we more than the owners of it. Hallelujah. To know and to understand the living God. And to know and understand specific things about Him. Because He's the one who's devoted to our blessing. Who exercises loving kindness. And judgment. And righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, says the Lord. I delight in you recognizing how full of love and kindness and tender mercies I am. I love that you delight in knowing how righteous I am, how faithful I am, how committed to my word I am. I delight in you knowing that my judgment could never be altered or perverted, that my decrees are stronger and more powerful than anything else that is put forth. Amen. Then the Lord says, and it's Jeremiah 29:11. He says, and of course I know that you know these verses of Scripture. I want you to grab a hold of them. I want you to be applied to you. I want you to put a big circle around knowing and understanding God, that you get to know Him, that grace has come to you and the pleasure and the provision of God has come to you, that you might know the eternal God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who He sent a spiritual insight, a spiritual wisdom. And in knowing Him, I'm going to tell you right now, the things of the Spirit, the things of heaven, the great exploits, the power of God that He's purposed and decreed and actually relegated to be only expressed to you and me will begin to have free course through us, because we won't be excited or disappointed or distracted or make anything else in this life important to us, because this is the grand prize and it's ours. And you're so captivated by heaven, you're groaning to step over into a deep... Because, I mean, think about Paul. It's like he was going to such the fullness of Jesus being manifested in him that it was almost like there was nothing left. But now stepping over into that realm fully, there's nothing left. I've laid hold of that which I was apprehended for. Stepping into the fullness, the ministry of Christ Jesus, where Jesus manifested in his mortal flesh, functioning in all the realms of the gift of the Spirit, having come not in any way short on any of the dimensions of display of the power of God, not left behind in any expressions of the divine. And he's just a testimony to you and me that we can have it too. And he shows us how it works so that we're not left out wondering, what does it look like? What must I do to inherit these things? He says, I commend you to the Spirit and to the Word that is able to mature you, build you up so that you can step into the inheritance that belongs unto all the saints. Listen, I know, I'm telling you right now, grab a hold of it, say yes.
Yes.
This is where I'm going. This is what I want to do. All the other stuff will begin to lose its appeal. Yeah, and it'll still tempt you, it'll still harass you, but it won't be able to take you anymore.
Amen.
Ooh, you become a master in it. You become an overcomer in every dimension of your life. Oh, ho, ho, ho. The fellowship and the relationship will suddenly, you will find such strength in it that your whole time is occupied by what God is doing and the instruction that he supplies. Visitation rights in heaven. Translation from one nation. I'm tired of flying. I'm tired of flying. I'm trying to translate. Hallelujah. Translated. I mean, I'm jealous of Philip. He shows me what you get to do when you're about the master's business. Huh? I mean, his willingness to leave the fanfare, the excitement, the joy of the revival of Samaria. That would be hard for anybody to do. Where the crippled are walking, everybody's excited. Peter and John's come down now. The thing's gone to a whole nother level, whole nother dimension. The power of God's broke out in Samaria, and the Lord just told him, go to the desert. I've got one key guy. He's like the one man in the great multitude at the pool of Bethesda. I've got one key guy. There's an Ethiopian. He's a key figure to a nation and two nations. Go to him. Go out there in the desert. He goes by spirit knowledge. Just doing this. What excitement. This is excitement. This is fun.
Yeah. Yeah.
You read that and you go, if you're not going, I want to do that, something's wrong with you.
Yeah.
You have settled out for something far less than what God has ordained. And tonight, in the name of Jesus, I release you. In the name of Jesus, you get excited. In the name of Jesus, hallelujah. You get a fresh wind of vision. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then the excitement doesn't end there. He goes, baptize the guy, and immediately gets caught away in the spirit like Elijah. Translated to Joppa. Amazing. Sets up a great church there. Some years later, you know, others like Paul and others visited. And he's got four daughters who prophesy. What a church.
Yeah.
The church of those who get translated. I mean, I don't know what, you know, what. I don't even think they probably any put titles on it. Just like the church at Joppa, church at Corinth, huh? Church at Galatia, church at San Diego, huh? We're doing the church at Quartz Mountain. Hallelujah. 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 His presence is just so wonderful here. I love his presence. I'll never take for granted his presence. There was a time in my life that I was just so caught away in his presence. I look at people and they're sad and they look like, you know, they're passing a kidney stone. And I think, you know, I get so frustrated. I get so mad. It's almost like I immediately just get pulled out of the joy realm. And it's like, what is our, you know? And I said, Lord, I'm not doing it anymore. If people don't want to drink, fine. Fine, I'm leaving them alone. Unless you tell me to get after him, I'm going to leave him alone. Because church is too much fun for me. I'm tired of letting people spoil it. Amen. You know what I'm saying? Faith comes upon the winds of the Holy Ghost and is received by a receptive heart. Me getting all upset ain't going to change the matter. I get upset because, I mean, I look at it and I go, my goodness, God has so much he wants to do through you. You're so much an integral part of this plan and you're sitting there stuck. And you're not stuck at all. You're just laying down in the muck. No, I'm telling you right now, when a cow gets desperate, its tongue comes out. It's this long. It just comes out. All you see is tongue. It's just a crazy thing about cows. And all the animals from all around, they'll all come to see what's going on there. There's nothing they can do, but they all come to look and smell. It's the craziest thing, especially when you can superimpose that on human behavior. It's the craziest thing. You go, wow, I've seen that somewhere before. And in fact, I think I saw that in church. And that's got to be shut down. That's got to be shut down. Now, Father, we just thank you that this baby that's getting ready to come forth. Hallelujah. Baby's going to be born. His name is John on 3:16. Yes, isn't that great? John 3, born 3:16. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Like 4 o'clock in the morning. It's already scheduled. That's what happens when... Well, let me just say this. You don't mind if I say, talk good about you? It's kind of bad. Kind of personal. I know. It's wonderful when you're in love and nothing can insult you. But I'm going to just tell you, here's what happened. The attending physician did not believe that Allie was going to live, so she cut her open like a cadaver. Did she? She sliced her open like a cadaver. There was nothing about the proper protocol for a C-section. And Allie went and confronted her. But it's just true. And we're not saying that all of that can't be restored and can't be healed because we have the faith for it. It's just the bottom line of it. I mean, you know, if you ask me, if I was going to have a baby, I'd say, put me out and tell me when it's over. Are you telling me that there's an alternative to push and breathe? Then I'm going with the alternative. I go with it. Wake me up and it's over. And so that's when it's like, leave it. And that's why she can call the date. John 3:16. Praise God. 3:16. His name's John Samuel. Praise God. I'm so excited because my seed should be mighty in the earth. And it's not, I'm boasting in God. I'm boasting in understanding and knowing God. And I get to understand him and know him. But why are they said in his word? And I personalize it and I say it's mine. And I say, you have no idea who I am, what God has made me, what he's placed within me. And I say, you have no idea who you are, what God has given you, what he's placed within you. Hallelujah. But in the name of Jesus, you're going to wake. You're going to wake. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're going to wake up. You're going to awaken. There's going to be an awakening, a quickening of these things. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And then they're trying to prepare us with all the things that was going to happen to Anna and what she was going to be and what was going to be like taking care of her and this and that. And it, lies. Lies. It's not true. Yeah. Amen. And the doctors give you a strange look when they're talking to you and you say, it's not true. Yeah. You say, well, you could have just kept that to yourself. No, I couldn't. That word of that death has got to be confronted with the word of life. It ain't about shutting up. It ain't about arguing. It's about declaration and decreeing. It's about shutting down the lies of hell, the intercessions of hell, the propagation of the devil. I mean, you got to turn yourself up, because if you can't be heard, nothing will be changed through your life. Hallelujah. And this is such a blessing. There's Joshua, and Allie just so hooked up. I just kept saying, just plaster Jesus all over it. I know you guys are worn out. You're tired. You know, hardly sleeping at all. Just plaster Jesus all over. Just stand in faith. Just stand together in it. And we're saying, no, it's not true. No, we don't have to do that. No, we're not going to do that. No, we don't need that. No, we're not interested.
Amen. Amen.
And they, you know, talking about getting, you know, social services and, you know, the other, you know, getting the authorities involved because somehow we're, you know, messing up somebody's life. They wish they had a child that smart.
Amen.
I'm telling you right now. That blessed.
Amen.
Praise God. She might be little, but she is mighty. Hallelujah. She'll tell you real quick if you're listening to the wrong music. Huh? So the other day they were at the house and Naomi started to sing a little song, little rhyme. She and Anna said, keep it to praise. I said, praise God. Hallelujah. Well, all of us need somebody like that in our lives. All of us. Keep it to praise, Naomi. Keep it to praise. Amen. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. The Lord says here, he says, for I know my plans for you, I know my thoughts about you. Even in the midst of this correction, even in the midst of the judgment, how much more in this place where we have been justified, where we have been sanctified, where we have been glorified, where we have been made holy and acceptable to Him, by Him, through what Jesus Christ did for us, when He's now poured out upon us all that Father has and freely and richly given to us all things. I know my plans for you.
Yes.
I know my thoughts towards you. I've got thoughts. My thoughts, which is expressed by my words, are all about blessing you and prospering you. Oh, in Jesus' name. You grab a hold of this in the name of Jesus. Thoughts of peace, not of evil, to give you an expected end. Having a relationship that you call upon me. And I'm answering you.
Yes.
You're going praying to me. Yes. Now hearken unto you.
Hallelujah.
You will seek me and find me.
Yes.
And now recognizing
you,
how available He's made Himself.
Yes.
How accessible He is to us.
Hallelujah.
That we have access by the Spirit.
Amen. Hallelujah.
My. Yeah. To grab a hold of it and understand how to begin to move in the Holy Ghost, to access all that He has.
Amen.
Access by faith.
Amen.
A faith that is persuaded of His love for us.
Yes.
A faith that is persuaded of that which He has purposed us and called us to be. When He enriched us with this authority in Christ Jesus and called us not only His children, but His heirs.
Yes.
His co-inheritors. And I pray in the name of Jesus that you get so empowered by this tonight.
Amen.
That you receive what He said in His word. Amen. And that no matter what comes out against you, nothing changes your opinion.
Amen.
About what He said. Nothing changes. It's already settled. Nothing alters, no matter what takes place, nothing alters your confidence in what God will do.
Amen.
Because as though some people have been a long time in the waiting, listen, I'm telling you right now, Father has it completely under control. And the wait's not forever. And the wait's not for long. The wait's not for much longer. And the reality of it is, as much of the weight, much of the weight is really about our response to Him. I want everybody to stand with me. Listen, I'm just so excited about the abiding place. I'm excited about the people of God in the abiding place. I'm excited about those who are on the fast growth plan and those who are on the slow growth plan. And I'm believing that everyone would get on the fast growth plan. Hallelujah. Father, we thank You for Your love. We thank You for the moving of Your Spirit. We thank You that You filled our hearts with praise. You filled our hearts with singing. You filled our mouth with laughter. That, Lord, You have become our song. You become my song and my salvation. The Lord is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. Oh, the Lord is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For the Lord, even Jehovah, He's my strength and my song. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Oh God. Go down too. I need to change the key. Same song. Let me hear it, bass. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Go up one. Hallelujah. I can hear you. Give me D. Hallelujah. God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For the Lord, even Jehovah, is my strength and my song. Strength and my song, oh, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. Oh, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. Even the Lord, even Jehovah, is my strength and my song, my strength and my song.
Fireworks.
Hallelujah. Well, let the fireworks begin in you. I pray in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth that your joy will be full. Yeah. That you will recognize that what God said by His Word, He spoke it specifically so that your joy would be full. That if you'll hear the Word of God and that you'll hearken unto the Word of God, that will be the response of your life. That you will have a supernatural smile. This is a supernatural smile right here. This smile has nothing to do with anything other than God the Holy Ghost at work in my life and through my life. That you'll begin to eat of the rich things of the Spirit. That you will begin to live in a place of such love divine, of fellowship. A fellowship. Who? It causes you to be able to experience all the fullness of God. And that you recognize that it's a time change and that you can spring ahead right into what I'm talking about. You don't have to wait. You'll find comfort in the Holy Ghost. That no longer will your ears pick up on all of the condemnation and all the accusation. No longer will you be receptive to fear and intimidation. But Jehovah, the Almighty God, we become His strength and your song. Just lift your hands right now and just be strengthened by the Spirit in your inner being. Those of you that are watching by web, there's no distance to this word of the Lord. There's no distance to this divine expression. And the Lord's not going to leave you in the expressions that you've had up to this point. A sound of heaven will begin to fill your voice. A laughter that's more rich. It will be deeper. A joy that will be more pervasive in your life and persuasive to your conduct and what you're thinking. A peace that passes understanding. A faith that works by love. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Turn this mic up so we can hear it, please.
The joy of the Lord is our strength. And if there's been a plug up where you haven't had the joy, the uncontrollable joy in your life, then check yourself, because you're trusting in the arm of flesh. You're not trusting fully in what God has. Because He will provide for us. He is our strength. And so right now, just reach out for it. If you need a belly laugh, if you need to be consumed by the joy of the Lord, which is our strength, then start sharing. Raise your hands and start sharing out. Thank you, Jesus, for the joy of the Lord. That is in this place.
That's right. Let's let the joy spring up. Go ahead, let the joy spring up. Let the joy spring up. Let the joy spring up. Hallelujah. Let the joy. Let the joy. Whoa. Let the joy well up. The joy is a necessary ingredient to rejoice.
Let the joy spring up. I know that there's people in here tonight, the circumstances and situations of life have imprisoned you because things are difficult. But what Father wants to help you with and show you is that there is not going to be any cure and remedy to your mind and your emotions and your affections being imprisoned by that issue. So I just want you to come right now, those of you who are under the load. I want you to come right now. I want you to just come. You're under the load. You're under the load. I want you to come right now. You're under the load. And the people I'm talking to hasn't even made a move. Haven't even made a move. The people I had no idea had any problem at all. You've moved. The people I'm talking to, not even made a move. You've not even made a move. I don't know what's wrong with you. Fathers, listen, you want to be quick to receive God's help. The people I was talking to, they're up here now. Praise God, they're already up here now. I don't want anybody to feel like, you know, I'm pressuring you to say, oh, is it me? You know what? You know if you're in prison to your circumstances or not. I mean, it's not like, you know, we have to have a moment of discovery. You know, it's not like a difficult question. You know whether or not you've been prisoned to your circumstances. It stole your joy. It stole your peace. And all that's going on here is the Spirit of the Lord is inviting you to get healed, to get divine help. Because if you'd start flowing and operating in the Holy Ghost and not letting these things overpower you, because if it can overpower you, then you are a slave to it. It's kicking you around and telling you what to do, and you have no power or authority over it, so you're mastered by it. And the Holy Spirit wants to empower you to where that you're not influenced by the thing. It can't steal your joy. It can't steal your love. It can't steal your confidence. It can't steal your faith. It can't steal the wonderful, you know, wonderful flow of the things of heaven in your life. Now, you can be used by God to bring the cure. Otherwise, all you're doing is it's meaningless prayers. It's empty, vain prayers. It's being in prison to the demonic realm, asking God to help you. And it's simply, God simply saying to you, come out of that thing. Surrender to me. Yield to me. And I'll work in the midst of you and through you to subdue it. There's this many people prisoner to circumstance and situations. It's like you gotta be kidding me. I mean, the Lord's really helping me block everything out. I mean, I like saw a couple people in the spirit towards the end of the meeting. You know what the Lord's doing? He's given us great boldness in the faith to effectively deal with every situation. To deal with it in His love, to deal with it in His boldness, to deal with it in His confidence. Hallelujah. To not have to struggle with it for, you know, 40 years. Or even 40 days and 40 nights. But to speak the word and immediately see the results. So what's happening over here? Oh, we got people that are sick. Oh, okay. Well, I'm going to get to the sickness. I'm still dealing with the people that are in prison to circumstance and situation. Everybody that's in prison to circumstance and situations, move to the center. And everybody who's not, flank out to the sides. so I know what I'm dealing with. I want, listen, what are you dealing with? What are you imprisoned by? I want you guys to speak to the situation. Are you imprisoned by something? You? Yeah. I want you to begin to speak to the situation tonight like this. With an authority that God gives in places within our heart and within our mouth by His Holy Spirit, where you begin to praise God that He is Almighty God and that nothing can stop His will or prevent His divine purposes in your life, that you're going to exalt Him as God. That you're not, listen, in the name of Jesus, I'm going to pray for you, for each one of you, to be strengthened by the Spirit in your inner being. Some of you are going to be strengthened by the Spirit to just get happy and glad and confident about what God's going to do on your behalf so that you can just rejoice in Him. Some of you are going to have to change your behavior because you obey what you like. You agree with God if you can understand it and you think it's good. You don't want to do that. You want to come under authority. And you want to agree with God and the things that you don't understand. And you want to find a place where you're under authority and that you have people that watch out for your soul and that a supply of the Spirit can come into you because Father wants growth. Just lift your hands towards heaven right now. I speak strength into your spirit. God, the Holy Spirit, will strengthen you in your inner being. He'll strengthen you a divine power to make a stand, to make a stand against circumstance, to make a stand against situations, harassing, tormenting things, whether they're domestic, whether they're relational, or whether they're financial, no matter what the situation may be, to where that it becomes something that has no power, no ability to influence your joy, your confidence. Because not only not let the rich man glory in his riches, don't let the poor man sorrow in his poverty. I mean, the Lord is putting it on the high points. Wines, riches, might. But you reverse the other thing. Don't be imprisoned by those things. Don't be getting, but let get your whole affections and whole confidence and whole, you know, value of life in knowing and understanding the living God who exercises loving kindness and judgment and righteousness. So just receive right now. 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 Just receive right now, Anthony. Just receive. You're looking at the wrong thing. Don't look at it anymore. I break this whole harassing, tormenting thing off of you. So you can be servant to God and nothing else. You can serve a good, a loving, a just, a righteous God who will never fail to uphold His promise. These hands of mine, these hands of mine, these hands of mine. These feet of mine, these feet of mine, these feet of mine. This heart of mine, this heart of mine, this heart of mine. Gonna work for you, gonna run for you. In Jesus' name, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the salvation, confidence, might, power, strength, that is nothing short of divine and supernatural, will not just be a spring, it will turn into a river. It will not be just a hope, but be a living reality. It's a time change, spring ahead. No, don't live anymore in the defeats of the past. Nope. But step into the success of your future. Huh. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, right now, be strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord. Yes? Yeah. Han stood. Han belay. Yeah. Lohoshirush. Ha. Yes. Tonde. Tole meto. Tando eketo aromoshe ponta. Ha ha ha. What happens is the Lord gives us the privilege to move in relationship with Him that produces such faith, you don't even know anything about circumstance anymore. Has no influence on you. None. There's no care there. And none. There's confidence, rather, in what God's promised to do. Lift your hands towards heaven. Now in Jesus' name. Now in Jesus' name. You know, God, He wants growth. Papa wants maturity. He does. He wants to bring forth Christ in you. Father wants to bring forth a display of Christ Jesus in you. That's not an unreasonable request. If He was expecting us to produce this, then it would be unreasonable. But He has supplied this. Look at me. How long will you be oppressed by this evil spirit? Because every time you present yourself before the Lord, you've compromised with an evil spirit. Why? How long will you do this? It's the things that you agree with. It's the things that you allow in your life. It's the compromises you allow in your life. You can break this thing, and it would be broken off of your children. It would be broken off of Katie. So, this doubt and unbelief that has been in your life, your whole walk with the Lord. It has nothing to do with reality. It has to do with something that you agree with that is completely fictitious. It's you exalting your word or the word of men or the opinions of men whose lives themselves are completely devastated and messed up above the insight and the word and the revelation of God. And even that word being expressed through people whose lives are right. That word which is validated by those who have taken hold of it and live in the blessing of it, yet it's still not been effective enough to throw down the lies of wicked men and evil men whose lives are a shambles and a mess. And whatever we agree with, whatever we submit ourselves to, we come under its authority.
So why don't you send this evil thing away and this compromise away and this agreement that is a wrong agreement away and say, no more will I agree with it. Because for you, it's a bit more than circumstance. It's believing a lie. To believe a lie is to damn yourself. It's believing a lie. And it's time tonight you believe the truth. If you simply believe the truth, you'll get the blessings of it. You let the Lord make the adjustments and the changes in your life tonight. He loves you dearly. The supply of the Spirit is here. But you can have the supply of the Spirit come to you every single, meeting. But if you just go back to the compromise, if you go back to the situation and submit yourself to something that is unholy and ungodly and literally submit yourself to demon spirits, well, that's just ridiculous. There's not going to be any profit to the touch of heaven. You have to say, look, there's a time change. I'm spring forward. So in the name of Jesus Christ, you be strengthened right now by the Spirit of the living God. To agree with His word, to cast down every tormenting, harassing lie of the enemy of your soul, that if you agree with it, if you listen to it, it will destroy you. In Jesus' name, you be released from this tonight, in Jesus' name, and you never allow it back in your life. If you're going to rejoice, a necessary ingredient is joy. You cannot sit around. Circumstance that would impose upon you sorrow is a terrible thing to give any recognition to. Isn't it? Isn't that silly? Would you like to be happy every day of your life? Joy unspeakable, full of glory. Well, the Lord has empowered you to be. You don't need to let anything harass you and torment you and push you around. So tonight, Jason, in Jesus' name, be strong in the strength of the Lord. Be strengthened by His Spirit in your inner being, in your inner man. So that you'll just agree with His word and laugh at death. And you're not even facing death. You're just facing a little, 2-foot demon. No, it's not even, it's like a football-sized devil who's mocking you. It's like a chihuahua. And it's scaring you and it's frightening you and you're running from this little chihuahua. It's time to turn around and deal with it. It just takes a stomp of the foot and a scat. And the thing will run away. It barely takes even the utterance of the name of Jesus. Just the residue of Jesus all over you is enough to scare the thing completely out of its existence. Joy is a necessary ingredient to rejoicing. In other words, to rejoice in the Lord always. Again, as they rejoice. I pray in the name of Jesus, you don't have no more circumstance. Circumstance become a former thing. Instead of having a circumstance, have a dance. Don't have no circumstance, have a circumdance. Amen.
Hallelujah. Don't you say what you're going to do with your life as though you were in charge and you sit around deciding A, B, or C. No. Say, oh God, you leadeth me. Oh God, he leadeth me. I'm on Derisa. I'm on Galiste. Bodhiristust. Bodhisistaristust. He leadeth me. He leadeth me. You men have some circumstance? Father, I thank you for the anointing right here on Jude. Hallelujah. Thank you for the wellspring. Thank you for the authority. Thank you for the power of the Holy Ghost being expressed in his life. Father, I thank you for the anointing on Jacob. Lo rabasaprafai. I thank you, Father, for your favor and your blessing in his life. Hallelujah. Father, I thank you for the anointing on Anna. Le ropo shiti libekele moora. Grambombrasai. Great boldness and confidence in the faith. Look from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet. Lo rabasataraba. Divine expressions of the Holy Ghost. Divine expressions of the Holy Ghost. Divine expressions of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Oh, Sadamane. Iribanda Elik Shelamosh Taparane. Bo robo ti robo bo robo ropo shilipo ropo. Mandip roshapaka. Mombrabata. Mombrabare de steli bolarabo copo papana menengalo poba shalama arapa kubifeli tai ekeha. Osuta aram ubopra. Enriched with all utterances in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Baba Badosis. Bifridish. Bivrefistis. Bivrefistis. The fire of the Holy Ghost. The fire of the presence of Jesus. The working of your mighty power, Father, I pray in Jesus' name. Right now, in Jesus' name. Right now, in Jesus' name. Right now, in Jesus' name. Jesus. 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 Do you have some circumstance? Huh?
I think yes.
How many? How many circumstances do you have? How many? No, everybody has one or two. Okay. It's just whether or not you give them power and authority over your life, where you bow your knee to it and say, circumstance, you my God, and you're telling me what to do from here on in. And I bow to you and I submit to your influence. Not a chance. Not a chance. You rise up against circumstance and you rebuke the storm. You tell the wind and wave it ceases. You tell the circumstances this is your stop. This is where you get off. This is your stop. Hey? Father wants has made us in charge. And if we're not willing to be in charge, we're going to get discharged by the situations that we face it. Be in charge. Let me tell you how easy it is. You just worship him. You say, God, you are God. You are my God. Lord, you are my God. And I am one of your sheep. You, my God, I'm one of your people. Let God arise. Listen, let your wellspring be turned into a river. Tonight, let your wellspring be turned into a river. Let your wellspring be turned into a river. Let your life be consumed by the presence of the Lord right now. He wants to do that. Let your life be consumed with the presence of the Lord.
Let your life be consumed with the presence of the Lord. Are you having to go to a public school or something? Oh, good. In the name of Jesus Christ, look at me. No more harassing, tormenting thoughts. No more. No more. Ezekiel, I give you peace. No, no. It's yours. Look at me. I give you peace. Supernatural. Jesus kind of peace. The other night, we watched a guy change. I just literally change. God shocked him out of his mind. He's waiting on us in a restaurant. The kind you go up and you know you order. And I saw a cross on him and said, "Hey man, there's a cross. Are you a Jesus man?" He said, "Oh yeah, I go to church. I believe in Jesus." I said, "Oh, you a Jesus man. It's pretty cool that you have a cross displaying that you a man of God." And he's like totally getting wrecked. Well, it's just so simple to take authority over a situation instead of being like a scribe and a Pharisee. Instead of trying to walk around, trying to tiptoe through whatever, you know. Start speaking the life and the power of God. Paul, you start doing this like never before. You start speaking the life and the authority of God. You start declaring, this is the way things are going to be. You see people harassed and tormented, say, "You know what, I see that you're harassed and tormented, but I set you free right now. I liberate you. You know all the stuff that's been going on in your life that you thought's good? It's all changing. God's going to come and reveal himself to you, and you're going to find out that there is another realm to live in, and you're going to love this realm. Let me know when it happens, because it's going to happen very soon. In fact, I feel it happening right now." It doesn't matter. Someone might break into a cold sweat, get mad. They might even, who knows, they might try to bite you. Who knows what they're doing? It doesn't matter. You're speaking with authority. Yes. Father's looking for some people who will speak on his behalf. Yes. Not speak about him. Yes. People who know him. Yes. Who are in him. Yes. And he is in them, and they've given themselves over to his utterances. Hallelujah. You're going to get this. Yes. Jess, you're going to get this. You don't have no circumstance. I'm here to notify you right now. You don't have no circumstance.
Amen.
Wasn't sure what you came up for, but I'm going to tell you right now, you don't have no circumstance that's going to rule you.
Amen.
Authority in Jesus' name. Let me tell you this. It's one of the beautiful discoveries of prayer. Where, you know, everybody has to deal with harassing, tormenting spirits, situations, you know, challenges, frustrations, you know, all that stuff. But when you find this realm of prayer and you begin to, you give yourself to the prayer to where that the stream turns into a river, the wellspring turns into a river in prayer, you have that breakthrough. All of a sudden, all the empowerment, all the focus, all the certainty, all the confidence of God comes perfectly into focus. And you just empowered with it. And all that stuff dissipates. You need that several times a day.
Yes. Amen.
I'm prescribing your fit. I'm prescribing to you. As a physician under the great physician. You need this couple times a day. And those are things that have been able to harass you and torment you. And we all forgetful. But the rememberer will, the one who brings us into remembrance will remind you. The Lord reminds me of these things more in prayer than he does in word. Because I know the word and I give myself to the reading of the word. And yes, the Lord strengthens me in his word. And there's a touch from heaven that comes from the word that is like no other. But it's the Holy Spirit in the midst of prayer that brings all of these things that Father has established into my life into perfect view.
and strengthens me in it where my resolve is so given over to what it is He's done. And without prayer, I would be just as overwhelmed and just as tossed back and to and fro as anybody else. But this is where faith builds up. This is where confidence builds up. Because you don't have off time letting the enemy harass you, kick you around, feeling discouraged, giving place to doubt and unbelief and disappointment. I have time for that. I have no time for that. Amen.
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 And I know what it's like to be in a workplace. Man, you can go in the bathroom and pray. Lock the door. Nobody knows what you're doing in there. It's a little wild if you start pounding on the walls. I can't remember who it was that went into the bathroom at one of the workplaces. And they were making a noise. I think it was actually Brad Scott. Falling out under the power in the bathroom. No, I came into work one morning. He was laying underneath the table in the break room. In a workplace, in a science research place of all things. Caught away in heaven. And I'm like, hey, Brad. I got caught away just looking at him. I didn't join him under the table. I don't have circumstance, I have faith. I don't have circumstance. Are you listening to me? I tell you right now, tonight, you don't have circumstance anymore. You have faith. You have authority. You've been empowered by the Spirit of the Lord and by the Word of God. To speak the Word by the Spirit. You speak the Word by the Spirit. My. You start applying these things and appropriating these things to your own life. Then they become effective and strong through your life for other people. Are we having a bit of an immune problem over here? Hey, are you having an immune system problem? Is it your immune system? Is it central nervous system? Huh? What's going on? Can you describe it? Can you tell me what's happening? Is it your endocrine system? Huh? Is it in your toe or is it in your ear? Where's the problem at? So we can get at it. Lord, touch the little man. Touch him tonight, Father, I pray in Jesus' name. May he feel good for the rest of his life. Hallelujah. Praise God. Fever, you go now in Jesus' name. Yo, foul spirit of sickness and disease. Sickness and disease has no right to express itself in this place.
Come on.
This is ridiculous.
Yes, it is.
Messing with us.
Yes, it is.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you.
In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
I command this fever to depart out of this body in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus.
In Jesus' name. Confident? Bold strength, when is your baby coming? 4 weeks. Joy's in the pouch. 4 more weeks. Father, we thank you that baby's going to be strong. How many children are you guys going to have? You guys are on it. I mean, if we chart this out, you guys are tracking for about 20, I think. That's fine, so long as we're going to get some prophets out of it, and some prophetess, and some signs and wonders and miracles. It's fine. Have a bunch of babies. Fine. That's good. Just we want them all to be full of the Spirit.
Amen.
Yeah. I think there's nothing so wonderful as seeing people who've got their whole family around them all full of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
And then you got grandchildren all full of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Huh? You just fill up the church, and you know everybody comes to people come to church and they find out everybody's related to everybody. And there's like 500 people there. The Lord did it bigger than that with think about Abraham. Like, in no time, he had 3 million. 3 million. Family members. Goodness gracious, what a church. Let's just do it right. Don't get off on other things. Things that belong to improper placed ambition. But be captivated by the Lord and then let Him open the doors for you. Let Him speak the word.
Amen.
And bring forth those things that He has ordained for you and I to have and express in our lives. We can't produce. We participate.
Yeah.
And He produces.
Amen.
We obey.
Amen.
We stand in the place and speak His word. And we are thrilled, thrilled about what God's been able to do with our lives.
Amen.
No matter how big or how small, no matter what sizes or shapes it came in.
Amen.
This is the place of maturity. Father's looking for maturity. Father's looking for growth. Thank you, Jesus. I'm just so excited about the future. Because I see my future in perfect obedience to God. In perfect obedience with Him strengthening me, empowering me, keeping me, perfecting, protecting, supplying all that I have need of and all that concerns me. And I want you to have the same confidence. I don't care what's been messed up in your life. God, I'll fix it up. God, I'll fix it up. You can't, but the reality of it is if you're not careful, if you don't allow the change to come through obedience, you're destined to continue to repeat the same kind of destruction and disaster and failure. Don't ever shut down excitement. Any expression of joy and delight in the house is fine with me. I'm going for anything. I'm just, hallelujah. I want it to grow and I want it to mature. But hallelujah, are you with me? And it will, it shall. Father's ordained, He's decreed it.
Amen.
Amen. I've just decided to quit struggle with it and go to praising Him for it.
Yes, amen.
That's all I just decided. Quit struggling with it. Quit wrestling with it. Amen.
Yes.
How many of you going to be happy all day tomorrow?
Me.
And just delight yourself in God. And just be blessed. Blessed coming in. Blessed going out. Hallelujah. Don't care anything about the things of this world, because all your care and affections in heaven.
Yes.
My goodness, when it's in heaven, you living in heaven.
Yes.
No more bound to the earth.
Amen.
That's right, tomorrow's miracle money.
Amen.
You know what? We started prophesying that many years ago. We started naming each day, right? Miracle Monday, Tongues of Fire Tuesday, Wonderful Works Wednesday, Thanksgiving Thursday. Just, you know, living it, just calling it. And then the Lord started just shocking us, freaking us out. Because you proclaim it long enough and you start seeing miracles happening on Monday.
That's right.
Just that, and specific, special expressions of thanksgiving that He sets us up to have on Tuesday.
Amen.
This is beautiful. It's beautiful. What we're saying and what we're praying and what we're prophesying, what we're declaring that God's Word has said is going much further than what we've thought. The expressions of God is taking us much further than what we thought. And all you and I got to do is get enough wisdom, sharpen up, recognize it, and then we're just going to be that much more devoted to obeying God and speaking forth His Word and getting excited or about who He is and praising Him and giving thanks, and more gets supplied. And more gets supplied. And more.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. And I'm just going to say this. Somebody came to me the other day telling me about their mini house. I got mini nothing.
Tiny house.
Tiny house. Mini, tiny. What? But you got? Do you have tiny face? Does tiny Jesus come along with that? Tiny works? Huh? Tiny joy? Tiny peace? Come on, give me a break. You're going to take a nation and you got a tiny thing. Come on, man. Enlarge your capacity before the Lord. Amen. You're in the tiny stuff. That smacks of human effort, human ability, human remedy, human supply. Faithless life. In the name of Jesus. I just had to say that. I just felt it came on me strong. Specifically for somebody in here. Maybe it's someone watching on the web. I feel it's in here too. Get yourself into the realms of what God has given.
Amen.
I've got tiny nothing. Amen. Mini nothing.
Amen.
Living in a, you know, kid's dollhouse. Saying this is the blessing of the Lord. Give me a break. Not blessing of the Lord. It's the supply of the arm of flesh. Get yourself a heavenly vision. Do it God's way. Listen, and maybe you know, things aren't as grandiose and big, and maybe you haven't lived in a trailer right now. At least it ain't some tiny something. It doesn't matter. You praise God for the, you know, just don't get into some millennial stupidity. I never even heard of this until the millennials come along. And they want to be hunter-gatherers. Hunter-gatherers. You guys. You guys were born like 3,000 years after your time. This isn't what the Lord's telling us. And people of God saying this kind of nonsense. Saying this kind of stupidity. You worship the Lord for what He's given you. Watch how He's going to multiply you. Because Father wants to, God, Father wants to enlarge you. He wants to increase you more and more. I didn't give Him mini nothing, tiny nothing. Everything Father does is big. The supply of the Spirit is big. I was telling some people the other day, and I want to finish with this. People want to be able to move in faith. But faith is a state of excellence. Listen to me. People want to be able to move in the gift of faith, but the gift of faith is about excellence. It's about excellence. And if you got a bunch of trash and stuff less than excellent in your life, you have no possibility of yielding to the realms of faith, the gift of faith. You don't, because you're not into excellence. I was telling some people on and blind. I said, you can still burn things without a permit right now. There's some stuff that needs to be lit up. Pile it up and light it up. Gather up your trash and your junk and throw it away. Don't half do things half-baked. Get a hold of God and say, I want it to be excellent. I want to represent the provision that Father God gives, the supply that comes from heaven. Because when you start doing this, because people are always saying, well, you know, when I have more of this and more of that, then I'm going to do it right. No, that's not the way God does it. When you give yourself to excellence, God says, okay, that's exactly, that I'm honored by that. Here. Here's the supply. Here's the provision. He doesn't want to, you know, just flop around, huh? Shower once every 3 days. Have a bunch of junk. They're actually, their closet looks like a garbage bin. Probably smells like one too. You get it in their truck and you need a shovel. Or their car, you need a shovel to make room for yourself. It's true. It's true. Half inch of dirt's there. Trash piled up. Mail from 2 years ago. And you say you're going to move in to get to faith. It ain't going to happen. You're fooling yourself. You're lying. The get to faith is about excellence. It's about what God does. I promise you, there is no trash in heaven. I promise. Just look at how God does it. You look at how God does it. You look at how beautiful it all is. And then the only thing that's messing it up is what man built there. It needs to fit in.
If you're one who is an ambassador of Christ and heir together with God and functioning in the realms of that which He inspires and supplies, then it's going to look like what He does. I've never seen a junkie. I've never seen a junkie tree. I've never seen a shabby bird. It just doesn't exist. Nothing shabby or tiny about it. And we pray in Jesus' name that you'll give yourself to excellence. That if your automobile is from the 1940s, and there is like everything's rust, it's got two layers of wax on it, it's so shined up, that rust looks like paint. You take great care of it, it's excellent. You take great care of it. Hallelujah. Now I can feel some people defying authority right now. They don't want to receive the word of God. They don't receive the rebukes of the Lord. They don't want to receive the instruction of the Lord. They want to go ahead and do things their way and have it all greasy. These nails, the fingernails that the Lord made, they deserve being clean. I don't know, somebody come laying hands on me and they got all, who knows? They got things crawling underneath those fingernails. Come on, man. Take care of the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Take care of the things that God has given you.
Amen.
It's really giving yourself to excellence is about giving yourself sincerely to move into the gift of faith.
Amen.
And if you don't make the connection, you're just mistaken. You show me a person who moves into the gifts of faith, and I'll show you a person who their closet's organized. Their car is clean. Huh? It might be older, but it's shiny. Huh? And there's always room to improve. I mean, the Lord just reminded me of something right now. I'm like, oh, okay, yes, sir. I just mean it immediately. I could get transparent and confess my wrong, but the Lord just... We want you to begin to move in the gift of faith like never before. God needs this. He wants this in His house. It's a means that it's one of the primary categories of how His great provision and supply flows to us. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you so much for your gifts and for your giving to the diversity of opportunities that Father has given to us. We're going after even greater diversity and greater opportunities because there's over 500 million orphans that don't have a proper food supply. When you talk about the widows that are in affliction and the people that can throughout the world that can be reached just by taking care of them, my goodness, it just goes on and on. Listen, Father is going to have some people in this place who can fund everything that we can think of to do. We're going after a realm of laying hold on the provision of God. George Mueller said, why advertise when you can pray? I mean, he was the first person who actually advanced within the framework of just the Protestant movement. You know, finances for the kingdom of God, raised up $6 million in his lifetime for orphans. And you know, there are so many champions in faith that have gone on before us. And Father wants to not just leave it there, but He wants to take it bigger. He wants to make it bigger, and He wants to make it bigger through you and me. It's not we're waiting around for somebody else to step up. That would be pathetic. I'm not waiting for somebody else to step up. Come on, man. I mean, we're gonna just do what God's given us to do, and praise God, hallelujah, and watch as He empowers us to do more. Because we're faithful. It's like I said this morning. You know, God gives you a dollar. And you're there faithful with the dollar, and the next thing you know, He's made you ruler over 10 kingdoms. Radical, huh? Just because of your faithfulness, you give yourself to excellence. Give yourself to excellence. Give yourself to excellence. Give yourself to excellence in your dress. Give yourself to excellence in the things that you do and the work that you do. Whatever you do, do it excellently. Do it heartily as unto the Lord. Whatever you do, whatever you have, make sure that it's neat and it's clean and it's well taken care of. You know, watch what Father will do through that. He'll just enlarge your capacity to be able to receive more. A part of that, a big part of moving in faith is the smallest acts of obedience. produce the greatest miracles of faith, the example of salvation. Everywhere we participate with God's word, He increases, He enlarges us. Through financial provision, the Lord made one of the things that the Lord made a key to this, and it was faithful, continuous giving. Faithful, continuous giving. And I'm just in expectation that the Lord is going to give, you know, some declarations and some decrees in this place about great prosperity. But when He does it, He's going to do it in the context of you and I having to step out in an act of obedience that goes way beyond where we've ever been. And so He waits for us to be ready to obey, too. He sees. The Lord knows the dynamics of our thoughts and our, you know, reactions to the opportunities that are set before us. So be faithful in your giving. Be faithful in your giving. And so I want to give you an opportunity, everybody here tonight, come worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings. Be faithful in your giving. Keep God first. Let the mortgage be second. Somebody said, I prioritize my bills. Okay, God's first. You need a roof over your head, so make sure the mortgage is paid. After that, what do you need? You need electricity? You can live without it. You need food. Let them turn the lights on. Keep a candle. Are you with me? You prioritize your bills. Right? But the Lord's going to take care of your electricity. I promise you. Hallelujah. 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 Somebody said, I need some wisdom for provision. Well, get yourself a job, and within 2 weeks, you're going to come into some money. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hey, find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in Jesus' name. Thank you, Jesus. Be thankful for everybody in the house. If there's anybody you're not thankful for, repent and get right with God. Amen. Start being thankful.
And then hug them.
And hug them, yes, amen. Hallelujah. I'm not a huggy person. I'm not going to come back to church here because I'm not a huggy person. Man, you need a breakthrough, buddy. You need to come. This is the church you need to come to. And you're not huggy. Something bad wrong with you.